Hey, what's up, buddy?
Hi.
You're the dude that killed all the people with AIDS, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I
Can you
heard
hear me?
about you on Reddit. Yeah, I can hear you just fine.
Good. Do you see my video or?
Yeah, you look beautiful.
Okay, you don't want to put that up on your Twitch.
Oh yeah, probably not. I don't want to cross the line too much.
That's fine. I'll take my video off then.
Aren't you streaming on YouTube right now?
Trying, yeah.
Okay. So
Let's see.
obviously,
Okay.
with you having the presence you do, it's kind of hard sometimes for me because I don't follow you too closely or as religiously as some of your fans. I don't know what you say that's truthful versus what is memery, but the gist I've gotten, I think, is that you're in favor of the Trumpster. Is that actually true, or?
So you want to talk about Donald Trump?
Yeah, if you want to, sure.
Sure. Favor is an interesting term. If you're asking me, if one were to ask me if I'd prefer to vote for Donald Trump versus Hillary Clinton, I would very, very narrowly vote for Donald Trump.
Ah, fuck. Well, it sounds like we don't disagree on much.
No.
Because I'm very, very narrowly for Hillary Clinton. I thought you were like a full-on Trumple.
No, he's pretty shitty. I just think she's shittier.
Yeah, I mean, I don't disagree. I think that I guess like I think the thing that edges it out for me is maybe just because of the type of person I am. I value intelligence like very highly. Like I think very highly of people that are intelligent, and I think very lowly of people that are very stupid. That sounds kind of rude to say, but I mean, I'm sure you don't disagree to some extent that a lot of what Trump says comes off as like very uninformed and very stupid,
Yeah,
right?
he's not too thoughtful.
Yeah.
I don't think it's an act.
No, it's I thought it was an act up through because he gave one speech at one post debate and he sounded so good. He was like congratulating Cruz on his win in Texas. He sounded like he was ready to turn things around. But then after that, he like went back onto the autism train and went full blown fucking retard on everything that he did. So I think we're pretty well past it being an act at this point.
What do you mean by autism?
I'm sorry. I'm a gamer. I use words like that. Or just stupid. Just in saying really stupid thing after stupid thing, like political stupidity, actual stupidity.
So you think it's okay to say autism when you mean stupid?
Am I being memed right now?
You're not being memed. I'm a healthcare professional.
A healthcare professional? Is that what the buying and selling? No, I don't know. It's probably not okay. I probably shouldn't say it,
Sorry,
but.
did you want to finish that sentence?
What? No, I'm good. Dude, you know way more about this shit than I do. I'm not gonna make the mistake of
Think
jumping
so.
into the jumping into debating the legitimacy of what you do.
I was developing drugs for autism spectrum disorder. It's serious illness, affects millions of people, and I just don't like.
Wait, how can you treat something like ASD with drugs?
How do you treat any illness with drugs?
Well, it depends on the type of illness.
Sure. I'm sorry, I'm missing your point.
I wasn't under the impression that ASD was something that was actually treatable. Like shortness isn't something that you can treat with a drug.
Sure. That's totally true, false as well. Achondroplasia is a genetic dwarfism that is treatable by drugs. So is short stature. It's the common
Sure, but I'm
character.
not talking about very specific
You're being
genetic,
careful.
like, I'm not talking about very specific, like, dwarfism or something that causes you to grow abnormally
Short
high. Just.
stature, short stature genotropin is a drug that's approved for treating short stature, just people who are short. It's human growth hormone. Some people use it for bodybuilding and things like that as well.
HGH isn't going to help you get any taller, though, dog.
Sure does. You might want to check the Carfax on that one. That's what it's used for. That's why it's FDA approved. For children with short stature. Is your Twitch stream cut?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, that's probably just my thing.
Hold on,
Yeah.
wait, do you have a link to this? I'm actually really curious. I'm not trying to call you out. I was unaware
You
that
can't
HG.
call me out, first of
Oh
all.
yeah, no, sure. No, I'm only saying things that I believe to be true. So if HGH actually helps you grow taller, I was completely unaware of that.
That's why it was invented, as a matter of fact. So here's somatotropin, 1987, FDA approval. Yeah, they didn't just pick me up off the street and say, "Here's hundreds of millions of dollars, Martin Shkreli. You're a good-looking guy that plays video games. You should earn all this pharma money." I do know a little bit about the field that I'm in.
Yeah, I imagine so. I guess it's very confusing to me. Why do people go to these weird countries and get these like incredibly painful leg surgeries and shit to extend themselves if they could just do it by getting HGH?
It's for children who are short. The point is that you seem to have somewhat strong opinions on a field you don't seem to know a lot about.
No, I don't have any strong opinions on this field. I've never heard of it.
Like, how could you treat autism? You can't treat...
No, I'm asking. I don't know how you could treat autism. I really don't know. Could you treat...
Well, sure. So there's illnesses that are psychiatric in nature, such as depression, schizophrenia, so forth, that are completely psychiatric, right? They're diseases of the so-called mind. They're not necessarily neurological, right? Those are diseases of the nervous system. So I can take someone who is literally raving lunatic, probably some streamers here on Twitch, and seeing things and literally out of their mind with delusions and psychosis, and then give them a drug called Risperdal or Zyprexa, and which are dopamine antagonists, and completely stop their delusions. And it's, to me, a miracle, right? Because at the end of the day, there's, you know, science, and taking science and manifesting it into helping people's lives is incredible. And so autism is not schizophrenia. It's a different illness. There's three cardinal symptoms of autism. The first, sort of some abnormal behavior or movement, some nervous tic or something. We all know people with autism that have that. The second is a profound communication deficit. So there's some serious social and communication problem with people with autism. And I might add that if you fail to exhibit all of these symptoms, you don't have autism. It is considered an illness. So if you look at, I know more about this than any of you lousy viewers, sorry to insult your viewership. If you look at a disease called Fragile X syndrome, this is the monogenetic variant of autism. So autism is pleo, or it has multiple different genetic causes, some of which are not even genetic. And you know, people in the gaming community talk about it a lot, and it's frustrating because, you know, Down syndrome is somewhat similar in that it has profound cognitive impairment. This is trisomy 21. This is having three copies of the 21st chromosome. That's also probably treatable. So any illness, quote unquote illness, can be treated. Some people with autism don't consider them to be illnesses, and there's this sort of idea that these are people who are neuroatypical, and that the same way we're calling people cisgender, some people with autism have decided to say, oh, I don't have autism, I'm neuroatypical, and you're neurotypical. And I think that's a little bit wild, but I'm not against it. I'm more against cisgender than I am saying someone is neurotypical, because so many more people are, quote unquote, neuroatypical.
Getting memed on right now? I can't tell if I'm getting memed on.
Yeah, I'm talking about medicine. I mean, I'm just...
Okay, the thing that you linked me about HGH is only for children that are exhibiting failures of the HGH production, which is kind of a little bit different than saying if you pump HGH into somebody, they'll get tall.
It's used for, no, if your growth plate has completed, there's concept of a growth plate, you can't grow anymore. the body stops you from growing.
Sure, okay, and pumping HGH. So if I was genetically dispositioned to be 5'9 or whatever, pumping HGH isn't going to make me 6'5, assuming I don't have some kind of deficiency.
But if you were on a growth path that is shorter than average, and you absolutely don't have any problems with Turner syndrome, or I mean, there's genetic reasons, right, why mm-hmm. you might be really short, but there are percentiles that you can measure your kid against. So if you had a kid, and I don't know the percentiles, but let's just say he was 20th percentile in height, you may just go ahead and give him HGH. A lot of families do that, which is kind of remarkable. They don't let nature take its course and have a 5'2 son because they know that who knows, maybe that's going to be a problem for the kid. To me, that's a little bit strange, but families do it all the time. And they say, no, let's get this kid back into the 50th percentile or higher. And that's what HGH is predominantly used for. You can feel free to check that out.
All right, I'll look into it later. I don't know enough about it to know one way or the other. I'll take your word for it.
The whole autism thing is frustrating because, I mean, it's there are specific cardinal symptoms. There's three specific domains of autism. And it's frustrating when people talk about it because it's you know, anyone who can communicate the way we're communicating
doesn't
have autism.
I mean, that's not true.
No, it's 100%.
No, that's absolutely not true. I don't know if you're miming on me or not.
That's 100%
true. No, that's not true. There's a wide diagnostic criteria for ASD. No. Just like there are people with autism that can learn to communicate effectively. Just because you're capable of communicating doesn't mean you don't have autism. That's absolutely not true.
So when people think about autism, they sometimes think about Asperger's or something.
Asperger's doesn't even exist anymore as of the DSM-5.
It
doesn't.
People think that's so-called high-functioning autism.
Okay, sure. These are all just ASD disorders or ASD things now. But...
Slow down, buddy.
Okay.
Most people with autism have an IQ of 70 or below.
Okay. But that doesn't mean that every person with autism can't have a conversation.
Let me finish.
Okay.
There are people with schizophrenia that have less delusions than others, but the average person with autism is profoundly impaired.
Sure, I don't disagree with that.
Yeah, and it's not reasonable to characterize the sliver of all illnesses have a spectrum. What people get confused about with respect to autism is that you can have one of the symptoms and have autism.
Okay.
That's not the way a disease that's multi-symptomatic works. If you have just aberrant behavior, you have OCD. You don't have autism.
Well, it depends on the behaviors, and I don't want to talk about it. I feel like we should just go. I don't know, dude. I'm hearing a lot of weird shit.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like the comparison of ASD to schizophrenia is totally illegitimate, in my opinion. Like,
they're both psychiatric conditions. I'm not comparing them in any other respect.
Yeah, but like, if somebody says you have schizophrenia, like, that's a pretty strong statement that carries with it, like, some very strong symptoms. Whereas people on the spectrum can exist, like, in a wide variety of ways. Like, there are people on the spectrum.
Schizophrenia.
Okay.
So most people with schizophrenia don't have enormous number of delusions. I think you're taking the extremely small amount of medical knowledge you have and blowing it up into quite a bit more than you have. I've studied medicine my whole life. I've started multiple large drug companies. This is a field I know well. I get very disturbed when people talk about autism and you're the one that says you have respect for intellectualism and stuff like that. I mean, I encourage you to be more intellectually honest about using the word autism and Donald Trump.
Oh yeah, sure, I am. You're just saying things that I haven't heard ever being said ever before in my entire life, so I don't know why you are privileged to this information that has never been shared before, I guess. You
might be having a long career in pharmaceuticals.
Possibly. Maybe you should get a career in marketing so more people learn about this stuff. I don't know. It seems...
It's my job to educate the world about diseases. There's hundreds of them. I mean, I have patents for diseases that nobody will ever hear of.
No, but you have a very real business and financial interest in educating people about diseases that you're trying to raise financial capital to do R&D to treat, right?
Yep. Like... I was in the autism business for a while. I'm out now. I was developing a drug called Syntocinon. I actually think I might have some right here. If I can find it, I'll take some. Oh, here it is. This is a drug that's approved in Europe. And I want you to actually pull up a window if you can. I really, you know, speaking of education, you're going to have a lot of fun with this. It's almost like a video game. Pull up a window and Google RMET, R-M-E-T, Reading the Mind in the Eyes Test. I think your viewers...
R-M-E-T?
Yep. We can actually test you for autism right now.
Uh-oh.
Are you willing to accept the challenge?
Yeah, if you want to, sure.
I think your viewers would love to know. Do you have autism?
I don't know, dude. It's possible. Let's find out.
Put it on your main screen, bro.
All right, let's do it. I'll bring it over here, dog.
It's 36 questions. I want to see if you can do it. I bet, knowing just... I'm a betting man. My guess is you're going to be on... Right on the edge.
Oh, fuck. We shouldn't have said it on stream.
Why?
I think too many people are visiting the site. It's down.
There's a bunch of them. Just Reading the Mind in the Eyes test, our MET site.
Okay, I'll try to find a different one, I guess.
You'll find one that works, I'm sure.
Test your socialintelligence.labinthewild.org. Do you think this is...
I'll find one myself. Let me see here.
Yeah, let me know if you find one. Don't mention it before I can click on it so that...
Do you have that much following? Amazing. Yeah, Yeah, every one of the links I'm trying isn't working. I had some of my followers. I don't have any followers. It's you, but I had some of my followers do it, and the results were staggering. The women on my stream did astonishingly well. Some of the men were. One guy who's actually has autism, diagnosed autism, tested correctly in the in the right scheme. There's not many of these. Let's see.
I mean, I'm looking at this test. It's showing me a bunch of eyes. Is this supposed to test my ability to empathize with people, to understand why they're making?
Does it allow you to actually take it?
I went to a site here. I'll link you. This is what I have up.
It's actually remarkably. Yeah, this is, let's see, how many questions are there on this one?
Quite a few. I'm not counting, but.
Yeah, I wonder if it's the full test.
The average score for this test is in the range of 22 to 30, correct?
That's the test, bro. Do it. This is like the greatest stream ever. Like streaming the greatest game you've ever streamed. This is the full test. I've taken this many times. It's 1 to 36, I believe. Let me add it up. 1, 2, 3.
Uh-oh, I got one wrong. Oh, shit, dude.
Yeah, it's 36, so this is the full test. It is extremely good at diagnosing autism.
I'm sure it's probably like a 99% accurate. Oh, shit, dude. I'm feeling it. I'm falling deeper and deeper into the spectrum with every question. Hold on, dude. I'm going to have to get my kid tested next if I... Because fuck, dude. What are some of these faces? What the fuck, dude?
No, bro.
Yeah, I feel like my autism is precluding me from understanding some of these expressions. Hold on.
It's a great test. There's another really good test that's I'll test you on in a second.
What the fuck? Okay. Affectionate or playful. These are like synonyms they can be. Fuck.
The person that publishes test is this guy who actually, you're going to be shocked at who it is, this guy named Simon Baron Cohen. And he's one of the leading autism researchers in the world. Believe it or not, his brother or cousin, I believe, is Sacha Baron Cohen, the actor.
The guy that did Borat and all that shit, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So Simon Baron Cohen... is a widely published autism researcher that has devised and published this test, and it's remarkably accurate. Obviously, it doesn't test the other dimensions of autism, like communication skills or abnormal behavior, but it's very good at the social element of autism, which is the third of the triad. Sort of social... communication and abnormal behaviors. Those are the three diagnostic criteria. And typically you really have to have all three, or one has to wonder if you truly have autism. And of course, if you have a genetic disposition like the so-called Fragile X mutation or the Rett syndrome mutation or any other genetic deletion, then that's also diagnostically can confirm autism. But this test is a very, very good test for...
Okay, so here's the question. I'm sorry if I come off sounding sarcastic. I'm not being sarcastic at all. I'm assuming that you're being truthful, although I'm not sure at this point. I'm assuming you're being truthful. I know that with certain neurological ailments, like antisocial personality disorder or whatnot, in order for you to actually be diagnosed with these, they have to have a negative impact on your life. Is ASD the same way?
It's a good question. I mean, when it comes to psychiatry, you have to understand that this is a field that is very unlike every other field. I'm glad one of my followers here just said tuberous sclerosis complex, which is another cause of autism. Psychiatry is like caveman medicine. It is so far removed from oncology and even neurology, which is a sort of a cousin of psychiatry in many ways. Neurology can deal with brain diseases where we have more exact understanding of what's going on, like a multiple sclerosis is actually, I mean, it's an understandable disease. Myasthenia gravis, very understandable neurological condition. When we deal with depression and schizophrenia and autism, it's so, just so, you know, wildly removed. And again, people with autism are a bit up in arms about being characterized as having a quote-unquote negative impact in your life, as you're saying. What is a negative impact? I mean, not having a job classically is one of the greatest diagnostic criteria for a negative impact. If you can't hold a job, if you can't finish school,
if you can't live alone, yeah.
Yeah, you can't have a relationship, if you can't, yeah, exactly. Live alone is remarkably used quite a bit in medicine. These are supposedly, you know, signs of a well-adjusted normal life. But, you know, people with autism say, hey, I am well-adjusted. I'm fine. I love my life. Why are you, you know, on my case? And that's this whole neurotypical, neuroatypical movement, which I kind of endorse. I mean, if there's someone who can work and they're fine with maybe even if they're not, you know, what's it to us to label them and say and shame them? I don't think it's right necessarily. But if you have a 70 IQ, and you can't communicate, and you have no social interest, I mean, it is hard for me to not characterize that as an illness. If you have an IQ of 95, you don't have friends, and you have some abnormal tics and movements and habits, you know, it's harder for one to say, oh, you're sick, you know, you're ill. I think that's something that's a little more touchy. I think what people don't understand is that most people with autism are actually, oh, you did great. Yeah,
I try.
28? You got 28?
I found an autistic guy in my chat, though. He said, how are you supposed to tell what people are feeling just by looking at their eyes?
What was your score?
28, yeah.
Yeah, that's fucking great. Yeah, that's a normal, well-adjusted, you know, socially understanding person. What they found, what's amazing in autism research, is they found that eye gaze, the ability to look in somebody's eyes, mm-hmm. Is also remarkably diagnostic. In fact, there's a paper in one of the most famous medical journals called Nature, where these researchers from Emory University, where I visit quite a bit actually, found that children, babies with autism, not even children, they lose the eye gaze that they keep with their parents, their mothers. They lose that eye gaze within weeks, sometimes, or by 3 months, if they've lost the eye gaze with their mother, they'll have an inordinately large chance of being confirmed diagnostically as having autism when they're 3 or 4 years old. They longitudinally followed these patients. And again, I think the gaming community is obviously well known for its insensitivity to a number of things. For a while, Down syndrome was hot in the League of Legends community. People would talk about, oh, you have Down syndrome or something like that. And they'd sit there and say, look, do you know what that is? I mean, I understand that I fed. But, you know what?
Well, do you see socially? Do you understand how those insults arise?
No, tell me.
Well, I think because people look for things that exist outside the norm, and then those are the targeted insults that you use to attack somebody, right? I used to say faggot a lot as an insult, and I try not to say that anymore because I've met too many people now that are genuinely homophobic, and I don't want to encourage that type of mentality. So then I think that, like, I guess it sounds hypocritical of me to say that but still say autism, I guess, is an insult, which I do quite a bit, I admit. But I guess people are just looking for things that are objectively bad, which I think we can probably agree, like autism or Down syndrome are objectively bad things. And then you just kind of label that to whoever you don't like as a way to make yourself feel better.
Yeah, it's sort of, I wouldn't say, like, I'm not a social justice warrior, but I spend my life making drugs and sometimes doing it in ways that people don't like. Most people, you know, crap on me for Daraprim, but they don't know that I developed one of the first drugs for a rare kidney disease that little kids get. And I spent millions of dollars doing it, haven't seen a return yet. I wasted millions of dollars on this stupid spray. never gonna get those millions back.
Sure. I don't think that people necessarily, obviously the public circle is a horrible place to have these discussions because feelings get hot and people in general are really stupid when it comes to anything financially related. But I don't think that people are, I don't think that people are upset that you were raising money to find a cure or to find a different drug to treat something. I think it's more just where the funding comes from starts to feel really abusive or exploitive, I think, to the average public person. Like, if you want to patent a drug and make tons of money selling it and all of that, but you need to raise financial capital for the R&D to do it, that's great, but don't do it by having us subsidize your research with higher insurance premiums or more costly visits to the doctor, stuff like that, I think is like the problem that people have in the United States.
Yeah. Yeah. See, the thing is, I'm a pimp. And I get guap, and that's just it. You know, what am I going to do? I can't stop.
No, I understand. Yeah. It's kind of like when people point the finger, I hate Trump with a fiery passion, but I don't think Trump does anything wrong with his taxes. If those loopholes exist, you have to, not only have, do you have to use them, you'd be an idiot not to, and you'd be irresponsible not to, because your company would suffer, your employees would suffer, and the people that are relying on you for that income would suffer because you have some arbitrary moral high ground by not utilizing an existing loophole, sure.
Yeah. I mean, I just finished my taxes and, you know, I had five people working on them nonstop, and we just got it in today. You know, today is the deadline for extended filers.
Extended from yesterday, yeah.
Yeah, and it's just fucking, it was nightmarish, you know, going through it all. And, you know, we had two different law firms, two different accounting firms all working on my tax returns. And, you know, when you're in a position like Trump or, you know, I would, his a very different position from me, but it's just one of these things where, you know, you can't imagine the complexity of filing a tax return like this. And, you know, I think that he should, you know, he should still release it, but, he's made so many mistakes, and the guy's such a putz in so many ways. But, you know, I think that Hillary is you know, like, I agree with a lot of the things that people say about her. And I'm curious how you respond to some of those, like, you know, she's corrupt and, you know, she's should be in jail. And, you know, what's your sort of,
I mean,
intelligent, reasonable person to another? What's your impression?
I could never defend Hillary. I really can't. I'm almost a single issue voter when it comes to campaign financing, which is one of the worst tests that Hillary fails. So I mean, and like, my girlfriend worked in security, or I'm sorry, not security, in defense. And like, if she had done anything even remotely similar to what Hillary had done, at the very least she would be fired, right? At the very least. And we're talking like accidentally walk out with a document, you know, walk out of a secured location with a document. Like, that would be grounds for probably instant termination, let alone giving, you know, a multitude of people access to servers with top secret information with no clearances whatsoever. Like, yeah. No, all of that shit is crazy. I think that Hillary is fucking horrible in every sense of the word, and even her political views are only, you know, whatever suits her at the time. You can follow her views on gay marriage or follow her views on 15 an hour minimum wage or whatever, and these are all things that she gets pushed to when it's politically expedient for her to believe in them. So yeah, I'm not a Hillary fan at all. I just think that Trump is so fucking bizarrely out there that,
don't you think it'd be fun?
No, I mean, the thing that bothers me,
how much can you care, you know? Like, I almost want to see what happens.
The thing that bothers me about Trump isn't Trump himself. I think it's what Trump reveals about America. I really do believe, and maybe this sounds hyperbolic, I really do believe that there are a lot of people in America that are still pretty racist, pretty xenophobic, a little bit too nationalistic, a little bit too rose-tinted glasses when it comes to American history, very evangelical. And I believe that that base represents a large majority of Trump's voting base. And that really bothers me that much thought still exists, I guess, in my country. 13 million people voted him through the primaries. I mean,
well, there's nothing wrong with being evangelical, is there?
When your religious thought takes over your ability to make rational decisions, there's something wrong with it. I don't think there's anything wrong with being religious, but when you're pushing for abstinence-only education, when you're pushing to outlaw abortion, when you're pushing to teach...
Is that evangelical or is that insanity?
Well, I mean, it's insanity that only comes from evangelicals. They're not one and the same. I agree with that.
Right. I mean, there's people, some of the greatest people I know are church-going people that are just really reasonable.
Yeah, they exist. I mean, I think the United States still has a lot of church-going, like, religious people. When I say evangelical, maybe I'm not using that term right. Usually when I hear people say evangelical, they're talking about a little bit more of the fundamentalist side of things.
Sure. Yeah, obviously we can all agree that, you know, you know, not teaching evolution or something you know, in favor of some crackpot theory or something would be very problematic. But I think that, you know, this whole, like, you know, support Trump because you don't like Hillary or support Hillary because you don't like Trump, it's sort of a tough, it's a tough place to be. But I think that we attach too much self-importance when we go through this election process. Like, everyone's, like, worried about what's going to happen to them or their country. And it's like, I actually don't really care. Like, who gives a fuck? Like, let it.
Well, I mean, it's
like, we'll fix it 4 years from now. Like, it can't do that much harm. Jesus Christ, you know?
I mean, I guess the worst. So there's two things going on. In terms of actual harm that the president can do, that's pretty much limited to Supreme Court justices, which I guess could have varying levels of importance depending on, you know, what ends up at the bench or what they threaten to overturn. I don't even know how that process works. And then how many, I guess, justices are up for nomination. So, I mean, that's probably the most important job that the president has, I guess, that and veto power. But the way that I look at it is, like, if you look at, like, your head of state when he's elected via democracy, which we kind of do, is representative of who you are, right?
Bro,
so, what?
Let's be real.
Yeah?
I don't know what you do for a living.
Uh-huh.
I have, you know, investments and shit. Like, it doesn't fucking matter to me who's the president. Like, what impact is going to have on your life?
Like, no, like, realistic impact, it doesn't. But, I mean, I feel like I'm not even that patriotic. But I guess as somebody that I am American, I grew up with very patriotic parents. I would like to really be proud of my country. But when you're part of a country, maybe you don't identify, like, as American. I'm not saying as an innocent.
I was born here.
But I mean, as identity. Like, I'm an American, you know? Like, I guess it would be nice to have a head of state that isn't he's like your main mascot, he's like your primary dude, right? That's like your big representative is your head of state. And if your head of state is somebody like Donald Trump, what does that say about the elector? What does it say about the people in your country?
I'm more open-minded of a person, like, I and maybe to a fault, like, I just sort of, like, there have been presidents that, look, I thought Obama was going to be trash, he was great, and I thought Bush was going to be great, he was trash.
Like, sure,
you know, what do I know? You know, at the end of the day, like, just let them run and let them run the country for 4 years, see what happens. They got pretty fucking far in the first place. It can't be that bad of a decision. Like, I think we just get so up in arms and partisan about it. And it's just like I've never smoked weed in my life. So this is a weird thing. But, like, everyone should just, like, smoke a blunt and just chill. Like, Jesus Christ. Like, we get so anal about all this bullshit. And, like, this is not going to change your fucking life. If you're fucking working at Walmart, you're still going to be working at Walmart. Even if you're, you know, a millionaire tycoon like me, nothing's going to fucking, what's going to happen? Like, just fucking relax. Like, who gives a fuck?
Well, I mean, but it kind of sounds like you're advocating for a complete, what's the word when you don't give a fuck? A passionate, you don't care about anything. You have total
apathy.
Yeah. It sounds like you're advocating for them for, like, complete apathy to politics in general, or?
No. I mean, I'm probably more apathetic than you are, but, you know, I just think that, like, the idea that you and others can control this wildly complex system with some of your thoughts, like, I just, it's unrealistic. Like, a good example is like, budgets and things like that, spending.
Mm-hmm.
Like, spending is controlled by markets. Like, you can, you know, if we wanted to make all these great entitlements and stuff like that, you can see, like, Obamacare was a great idea and I support it, but you can see it's sort of not working sometimes. And that the problem is that ideas, as my mom would say, that your eyes are too big for your stomach. You know, the vision of Obamacare is a massive sort of expansion of Medicaid and Medicare, which I'm not against,
mm-hmm.
but it costs money and it costs a lot of money. And we just don't have infinite money. And so markets will decide whether Obamacare succeeds or doesn't.
Sure. Can I ask you a question on that specifically? Why do Americans spend so much more per capita, but seem to get so much less out of it than other countries with, like, single payer, like compared to, like, the NHS and the UK or Canada's healthcare system?
It's a great question. Sort of all over the place answer, because each little part matters.
It's a little bit of the, yeah. Well, a lot of people levy criticism there. The insurance companies come under fire there, that they're a leech on that system. And
I can take each part of it. One of the more interesting parts is the drug part.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a thing. So what's interesting is if you make a brand new awesome drug that's a great cancer drug, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, we can all agree that's great, right? And like Merck just came out, Merck and Bristol Myers both came out with a drug. They're very, very similar to each other. They're called PD-1 antibodies. And I mean, they're like the greatest fucking thing that our drug industry has ever done. They extend life for people with cancer, which when I play League and I feed in silver, I need this drug sometimes, but it's...
Wait, why do you get to make cancer jokes and I can't make autism jokes?
Well,
never mind. Move on. Don't worry about it.
Gives me cancer. Yeah. Oh no. I'm sorry. I'm trying to be topical.
Yeah, sure. Okay. Thanks for using it in terms that I can understand. Go ahead.
Yes. if it gets really bad and I'm like 0-12 with Ezreal or something, I'll be like, this is metastatic stage 4 renal cell carcinoma.
Sure. And sometimes I start banning people in chat and I become this antisocial monster and I feel like I'm exhibiting traits of ASD. So I feel like I use it appropriately. But well,
clearly you can now tell your users that according to the RMET.
Yeah. But if I were to take that test after going 0-12 in League, I bet I would only score like a 10 on it. So,
so anyway, there's this great new cancer drug. It's close to $100,000. It's the same price everywhere, though. And if you're in, let's pick a country like, I don't know, fucking Algeria. It's a modern country, Africa, but it's probably one of Africa's most successful countries, but it's still pretty poor. They can't afford this drug. Merck says, go fuck yourself. Sorry. Greece is a country undergoing a lot of challenges. Mm-hmm. Roche has a couple of cancer drugs that are similar. Roche told Greece to go fuck themselves. It said, when you become a first world country and you can pay for our medicine, you can get it. Until then, you're a third world country and, you know, maybe you can apply for our donations or something, but you're done. You know, we're not selling to you. You know, we'll have a humanitarian aid project, but that's where we're bucketing your crappy country. And so for new drugs like that, that's the state of affairs for the entire planet. You either can pay this new high price that reflects this costly innovation, or you can't.
Yeah.
If you can't, we're going to try our best to ship you some free drug and stuff like that. But in general, you want to be on that list where you can afford it. And countries in Europe, what's fascinating is they'll bitch about it. They'll come, they went to this one company, Vertex, that has a cystic fibrosis drug, and the entire country of Scotland, which I, you know, it's part of the UK, obviously, but there were entire countries, I think France might have done it too, where they literally said, no, we will not have it. And this is like a cure for certain patients with cystic fibrosis who would die without it. And they said, no, we will have a firm line, you know, against this. And they capitulated and they pay the full price. Because at the end of the day, the, you know, this sort of idea that, you know, to save somebody's life, it's pretty valuable to society to be able to do that. And we don't want to be a country that is sort of a third world country. So that's sort of most modern medicines. Now, the problem results in how we deal with kind of older medicines, like the one that I bought. I recognize that in Europe, you can't do what I did with Daraprim because of single payer. And there's pros and cons to that. The con is to me is that I lose a lot of money. That would be a pro to you.
No, I'm not like that. I'm all for capitalism. Okay. Sure. I mean, but the con would be that there would never be the motive to develop that drug because there wouldn't be the money there in the first place, right?
No, this is an old drug, right? I mean, it was the Daraprim was developed a long time ago, and I'm being totally serious when I say I'm at odds with, in many ways, society benefits from. The rules are what they are. In the U.S., drugs are not paid for by a single payer, and And basically, there is actually an incentive for their prices to be higher, which is a really kind of crazy concept.
In single payer?
No, in our system.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah.
There are forces that actually drive that price up, which is not just people like me, but all the players in the healthcare.
Sure.
Want higher drug prices, and that has to do with the way insurance works.
Yeah, because people don't shop for prices. You never look for a cheap hospital, and things are never advertised as priced out, and yeah.
Insurers make more money the more dollars flow through their system. So they kind of tacitly love higher prices. And then, you know, so that's sort of one big problem, so to speak. Now, an honest drug industry, to me, I'm not sure that's as much of a problem as people think, because clearly we have mechanisms to pay for high-priced drugs. They exist. Everyone gets our medicine and I think can't afford it. The problem is, what does the industry do with that money? And they're not, the industry is not very good at taking that money and making great new medicines. The Merck drug, we get one of those like every 3 decades or every decade or so. We don't get drugs like that drug every day. And the industry is pretty wasteful. And what I found is that, and if we want to switch topics, I'm happy to, but one of the problems with our industry is that of the top 15 or so drug CEOs, drug companies and their CEOs, not one of them is a scientist, maybe one. And if you look at tech, it's totally the opposite. All the top tech companies, especially the successful ones, you know, Zuckerberg was programmed Facebook. Gates, you know, was a developer as well. The Google guys wrote Google for Stanford. They actually had hands-on experience. So I think our industry needs better science, to be honest, and less sort of businessy people. I got my first patent at 30 for a brand new medicine I invented. I think people like me should be at the heads of drug companies, not people like this big London drug company just named their new CEO, and she ran their consumer business that sold toothpaste before. And I'm sitting here saying, like, you know, she doesn't know anything about a drug, and I don't know why she should be running this company. I want people that understand the business, and the more we have of that, the more people that are really fanatical about medicine, the way I hope I portrayed myself as, you know, I love medicine and I love reading about these illnesses and trying to fix them and grabbing money to do so because I don't trust Wall Street and the venture capital community. And it's not easy to raise money, especially from, you know, I get the sense that you're somewhat contemptuous of a lot of other people's intellect.
No. I don't hate capitalism or raising money at all. If I gave that impression, I'm like an insane, like, leftist.
What I said was that I think you look down your nose at people who aren't very bright. You would be spending a lot of time looking down in the Wall Street world. Most people.
I mean, I'm sure they're probably intelligent at the things that they specialize in, I imagine. So,
you know, the average hedge fund is losing money this year, which makes no sense because the average hedge fund is performing less than the index, which is like, I could do better by not paying.
That all kind of goes into all the theories, efficient market hypothesis, right? That people don't ever beat the market on average and whatnot. I guess I'm backing up a little bit just cause I'm kind of interested. In the scientific research world, the competition for funding, from what I read, seems to be the major complaint of every scientist. If there's good research to be done, but it's not interesting, nobody funds it. The profit motives seem to fuck everything up, or as you call it, like the market seems to not select for things that would be positive to the scientific community because there's not as much money behind it. Do you ever feel like in the healthcare world that it seems like it's more like kind of a bureaucratic system than like a system that exists for scientific research to deliver that scientific research to sick people?
Yeah, it's a sort of a messed up field because there's two big areas of scientific research. There's the bench research, which is almost overwhelmingly done by universities. Mm-hmm. And it's, by the way, especially well done by not American universities.
Yeah, unfortunately, yeah.
Well, you know, we're great at it too, but...
I've seen like all the different things and like the amount of scientific research that used to occur in the United States versus Europe, and those charts have like equalized out hardcore, whereas the United States used, although I guess that's probably because Europe has caught up in a lot of ways as well. But
I think you know, we do a great job, but I'm just sort of giving a nod to the rest of the world.
Sure. Okay.
The second part of the research I'm not going to, but the first part, look, I mean, there's great genetic discoveries all around the world, even more so now in China and India. It's great. The whole scientific community is doing better. All of that funding is done by academics. We have our NIH system here in the US that gives grants to those academics, and it is a clusterfuck. Industry does not help with this research, which I think is a huge mistake. Mm-hmm. But it's basic research that is, you know, you illustrate some of the problems with it. The second part of the research is the part that I'm much more familiar with, which is actually taking a discovery, so to speak, and making a product out of it. And when I say product, I mean a therapy. You know, it's a therapy to the patient, but to an executive, it's a product. I'm just being very cold about it, but a drug. And that process is only done by companies. Universities don't do that. It's also a much more expensive process. And Americans are better at it than virtually anyone. there's no European Genentech. There's no European Gilead. There's no Chinese Celgene. All these are American companies that have changed the world with great new medicine.
Do you think that they wouldn't exist in those countries if America wasn't so preferential to them? Do you think they would just cease to exist entirely?
I actually don't think America's... Like, I started touring my drug company in Switzerland because tax codes. But it's the American hunger, really, more than anything else. It's the American dream and drive to become a billionaire or whatever. Like, that's what I think all the... And look at tech. Facebook, Google. Why is there no... You know, there's a Baidu. But in general, I mean, where's the Facebook of Europe? Where's the Google of Europe? Where's the IBM, Microsoft, and Apple of Europe that doesn't exist.
Sure. For the social media, I wonder how much of that has to do with the fact that American culture is still pervasive rather than just the technology too. But yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah.
What about Google? I mean, there's just sort of like this drive that Americans just want to make money, love to make money. And I think that it's just a little less drive elsewhere. It doesn't mean that there aren't great European internet companies or Japanese pharmaceutical companies. There are, but especially in terms of entrepreneurial startups, there hasn't been a new Japanese drug company in like 50 years, which is like, how does that work? You know, it's sort of, you know,
I imagine like at one point with the United States being the home of, I guess, according to you, like massive pharmaceutical research and whatnot, why would you even bother to start, you know, something in another country if America's already trademarked itself as being the best at doing that, right?
Yeah, no, it's a fair thing to say. But I mean, I think that, you know, I'm curious how you would think about this. One of the things I dislike about Trump the most is this "Make America Great Again" concept. Mm-hmm. So I think America is great, and I think that, you know, trying to fix what isn't broken is sort of a great way to break something. And this whole idea that, you know, America's in big trouble and it's a huge disaster waiting to happen and he's going to save the day, I don't know who buys that. Like,
I mean. Well, with the way that the media works these days, it's like, I think it's pretty obvious. I don't want to say obvious, but like, I mean, like if you look at the way that crime reporting and terror, like if you ask the average person, like what's like some of the biggest threats to your life, like it wouldn't surprise me if a lot of right-leaning people would say things like, I think that terrorism is a big threat, even though they probably have a higher chance of like dying to a shark in Maine than like actually being killed by a terrorist, you know? So I feel like the super over dramatizing of everything by the media plays into that. Trump was making those comments where like we're the most violent we ever have been in the past 40 years, which is absolutely absurd to anybody that looks at any violent crime stats. Yeah, I don't know. It feels like the media feeds a lot into that crazy sensational thing. My favorite thing to ask those people when people say "Make America Great Again," I always ask what year do you want to go back to? Like for Jim Crow laws, or not that far back? Do you just want to go back to where like gay people couldn't get married, or do you want to go really far back before women could vote? I don't know what "Make America Great Again" means. Like what time period are you hearkening to? Like
that's very snarky and I think effective, but I think you're touching on exactly what you said earlier, which is, you know, people are more racist and more, they want to be more open about, maybe more open about it.
Yeah.
And that's unfortunate. I think that economically America's is at this point is as good as it's ever going to get. We have this high tax rate that is quote unquote so bad and so forth. You know, I was looking at Facebook's financial statements. They're an American company. Mm-hmm. They pay 40% taxes. It's unheard of. When I moved to Switzerland, my company to Switzerland, I turned my 30 – America's 35% federal tax rate. And then sometimes even companies have to pay state and city taxes, and I think Facebook does. So I went from 35 to 11%, and it was worth it for me to sort of have to set up a Swiss company and do all the things I had to do. But like if Facebook can start in America and become a $300 billion company with the quote unquote, you know, huge tax burden, like cry me a river. Like I want to say I regret doing the Switzerland thing, but if the difference between your success and failure is whether you have a 35% tax rate or 11% tax rate, like I don't know.
That's kind of a big... That's a big difference. I have a hard time believing that Facebook pays an effective 40% tax rate,
yeah,
though, on...
Absolutely.
Really? I'll go look at it later. I don't doubt you. It just seems really hard to believe.
There's a couple other companies that do it too, and eventually my guess is Facebook will be a little smarter about how they do it. And you could be right that they actually are telling us that they're paying a 38% tax rate, and then they actually don't. Oh. Companies do that all the time. The accounting rules are a little bit finicky that way. You can actually say that your tax on your income statement, that your taxes are X, and in the footnotes, it'll explain that, no, well, you add the tax credit that we got.
Yeah. One of the worst, the thing that I fucking hate the most, because I'm self-employed, so I get paid via 1040, so I have to know a little bit more about taxes than the average, W-2 filer, and I'm sure you know infinitely more than me. But even with the little bit I know, it's really frustrating listening to people only talk about, the posted tax schedule. And so somebody will say something like, oh, you know, if you make a lot of money, you pay 35% taxes. Like, well, 35% on what? Like, first of all of this income isn't even ordinary income, and then you've got all sorts of tax credits and deductions. Not every single dollar you've made in that bracket is taxed at that bracket. Like, if you make $100,000 in a year, all of that money is being taxed. Like, talking about taxes, like tax rates versus effective tax rates, is like a huge fucking trigger for me. I get like really irritated when.
Yeah, and in companies, it's even less clear. And I don't know. For me, politics is like, it is an exercise in futility. So to like, I think it's funny when people, I see them on Twitter, they get worked up over like Trump or Hillary or something like that. I'm like, you need to take a deep breath, realize that you don't matter, they don't matter, and you're getting worked up for nothing. At the end of the day, you gotta do you, be happy. And if for whatever reason, like whatever you're angry about in your life, like for some reason you think Trump and Hillary are gonna be a good outlet for you, maybe psychologically that's healthy for you, but the reality is you should be worrying about your family, your job, your friends, what you like to do for fun. Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton are gonna have absolutely nothing to do with you. Our country will be fine with or without your vote. Like, I just don't, you know, this idea that, like, you know, it's romantic that we, the people, steer this democratic process. And it's certainly true, practically. But again, we're ignoring these other influences. Like, when we run up a big deficit, that's going to self-correct. It can't continue forever. A lot of these policies are not going to be ones that we choose. You know, the president has to go with the tides as much as, and the country, the Senate, all of our branches, they have to go with the tides as much as they do with public opinion.
Yeah, sure.
On deficits forever. I mean, no matter what the politician wants.
Yeah, and hearing Trump say that his solution to trade deficits, which aren't even necessarily a bad thing, is to tariff every other import and then bring all the manufacturing back to America to fix our deficit.
I pray that he's trolling and
I don't think so, because he hasn't trolled about anything else. Why would he be trolling about that, you know? Like,
I think it's one of these politician things where he's just saying that to win the Rust Belt vote, because he needs that to get elected. And then when he gets in office, he's gonna say, are you kidding me? I'm the guy that has his ties made in China. Are you fucking joking? I'm not gonna, you know, that's crazy.
I used to believe that, but I don't know anymore, dude. I don't know. He said some of the worst things I've ever heard a politician say. Talking about that judge that's literally whiter than you or me, who is a Mexican because his parents were Mexican, the federal judge that was literally born in Indiana. Like, I don't know. He said some crazy fucking shit.
I think he actually, like, you know, because, and you probably notice, I mean, everybody notices this, people that are, you know, 70.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, a little racism that
just a little bit,
you know, and yeah. It doesn't mean they're bad people, but they grew up in a different world that we did. And sure. I think that he probably speaks to a lot of those people that say, yeah, that stupid Mexican judge, I can't believe it. You know, and it's unfortunate, but I would pray again that is intellectually just a game to get elected, and you play the game to win. And he's doing everything he can to win. But the reality could be that, yeah, he's just sort of this loose cannon that says whatever he wants. But again, it's not going to make a fucking difference to me. I'm still going to be streaming on YouTube. You'll still be streaming on Twitch. I'll still be feeding on League of Legends. You'll still be playing whatever game you play. And it's just not going to make a difference. You know, I can't imagine the amount of real estate it takes up in our head versus, like, I could just be learning something useful. I could learn JavaScript and actually have a fucking skill at the end of the day and just turn off the TV when it comes to elections, and I'll be totally...
Yeah, you'll be the same, more or less. Or, yeah, even better off, because then you're not stressing over
stuff.
Yeah. I guess, like, with that type of apathy, though, don't you think that kind of apathy runs counterintuitive to the entire point of, like, a democracy? Like, aren't we supposed to have a well-informed voter base that can make intelligent, you know, decisions on voting for people?
I sort of trust my peers, and to me, the American, like, my family came to America from Albania, a really dirt poor country, and they came here for a quote-unquote better life. They didn't come here to represent the American people. You know, they came here so one of their kids could get rich. Mm-hmm. And it worked. And great. But, you know, this idea that we're all going to sort of have this common voice, and that my little old mother from Yugoslavia is going to, you know, partake in a political process. It's a ruse. You know, I think that this idea that, you know, you talk about campaign finance, I donated $2,700 to Bernie.
To Bernie, I saw that.
Yeah, at the time it was the most amount of money that you could give to him. And I don't like Bernie Sanders, but my theory on it was that every time he asks people to, quote unquote, pitch in $5 or chip in $3 for his campaign, I that disgusts me as much as Boeing giving, you know, Hillary Clinton $3 million. Because I think that Boeing doesn't need the $3 million. The person pitching in $3 may need it. And when I donate $2,700, you can do it twice to make $5,400. I've equalized like 3,000 people in one fell swoop because I have more money. And, you know, while it's true that you could raise money piecemeal, you know, Hillary Clinton's raising money from super PACs. And I think this whole idea that you and I matter in politics is it's a little bit too kind of indirect. I'd rather control my destiny in my life, no pun intended, than sort of pretend to be partaking in some system that for no reward.
So you know, I guess like
just greedy and, you know, so forth.
But in terms of looking at the difference from raising capital between the way that Bernie does it versus Hillary does it, all the things that you say about pretending to be involved in the political process, I feel like a lot of that ties into funding. Like if somebody goes to Congress and they're writing laws, they don't give a fuck what I think. They care what the people that fund them think, right? I feel like that was the So I guess, because I'm looking at like you saying that you don't like the way that Bernie raises money, but I feel like if Bernie makes, or if any politician makes all of their money from the actual people that live in the places that they're supposed to be representing, then the politician is more likely to represent those people than if they get all of their money from a select few businesses, right? Because, I don't know, like I look at, there are so many like laws and shit that are written by people, or wrote by people, that are specifically doing it because they have backing by a certain company. That it
sure,
yeah.
Sure. No, I don't. Yeah, I'm not. And I'm not saying at all that if we lived in a, we would be living in a better world if there was no ability for a company to contribute, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's no doubt about that.
Like when we talk about things like the big financial crisis, the big housing bullshit of 2007, 2008, like if you look at Hillary Clinton's financial backers, like is she really going to be the politician to rein in the banks? Like,
yeah, of course.
Probably not. You know, and if another thing like that is brewing, is she going to be the person to call them out on it? Probably not. You know, like,
yeah, no, I know, you know, I was in hedge funds and being a successful entrepreneur, I've been approached by lots of politicians for cash and, you know, it's there's no, you know, no one's stupid enough to say, I'm going to do this for you if you do this.
Of course.
There is, you know, I'm not giving you money for fucking fun. You know, it's there's better ways to have fun. It's because I'm trying to influence you.
By influencing, yeah.
You know, and or, you know, I see eye to eye in 80% of what you say. And I also want, like, I gave money to this one guy in Maryland. And Maryland's important because that's the FDA. And I gave him money because he was a Democrat, by the way, and I liked the guy. He was a young black guy, and you know, I sort of said we need more, you know, diversity in our House of Representatives. He would have been the second or third youngest guy in the House, so I said, you know, I mean, that would be nice. I gave him some dough, and you know, I sort of understood that not only was this sort of a good thing to do. But look, 2-3 years down the road, you never know. I might have to call him and say, "Hey, you know, this guy at the FDA is bothering me. Go get rid of him or something." And you know, having that made that donation will put me in a better position to be heard. He's going to pick up the damn phone, that's for sure. Then vice versa. And you know, when he runs into the FDA commissioner in the hallway, he's going to say, "Hey, do you know anything about so and so?" And these things happen, whether you. You know, and I don't think you can stop them. And I think that if you donated the presidential campaign, I think the limit's like $34,000. If you donated $34,000 to Bernie and you tried that stuff, it's a lot easier for him to say, who are you? No, go fuck yourself. Versus Hillary Clinton can't do that to George Soros.
If somebody from Lehman Brothers or somebody shows up at Hillary Clinton's doorstep, yeah, they have her ear.
Oh God, you know, in fact, you know, it's a puppet master thing because, you know, I mean, these donors, they follow each other. I mean, I look to, you know, what the Koch brothers do. I look to what these other guys do. And, I say, yeah, that's some you know, someone I want to kind of, you know, work with. And, you know, it is scary. And I think that Bernie, you know, my donation to him was sort of a nod at how absurd the process is. Mm-hmm. And he gave me, I got this, you know, it's a machine, you know, the idea that he's not a machine though is sort of silly because I got the sticker in the mail. You know, it was automated. It was like a factory.
I get a sticker,
I get a letter, like, oh, it's so cute, I'm a part of this process, you know. It's kind of bullshit.
A little bit, but kind of a false equivalency. Like, I do think that the funding via lots of people is better in almost every single way than the funding from a few select people. Although there is, of course, a certain degree of groupthink bullshit that, you know, slap the bumper sticker on your car and all that shit that goes along with it, sure.
I think it's better that, it's certainly better. No one could disagree with that. But I think that, so we're totally see eye to eye on that. But I think that, it was a little naive for him to say, no, this is a political revolution, let's go do it. And the idea that, like, this is the first time that, like, an older guy has motivated a bunch of naive younger people to give him money and to be a political, quote-unquote, political revolution, it's sort of intellectually dishonest on his part. And I don't know how much money he raised, but I have the number 100 million strikes is sort of in my head for some reason. Mm-hmm. That money should be... would have been much better off in those people's hands than his hands might.
Yeah, I mean, it's possible. I do think that he was a little naive in thinking that he wouldn't have to play the game at all, right? Because you could see that he very clearly wasn't interested in playing the game. And because he didn't, he got fucked, like, really hard. Yeah. That being said, it feels like, and I'm totally honest, my knowledge of history and geography is very fucking bad. In my lifetime, I haven't seen a political climate that would have gotten Bernie as far as he did, right? It's the same political climate that has elevated Trump to the position that he's in. So I feel like if this would have happened 4 years from now, and we would have had another establishment candidate, you know, for the next 4 to 8 years, I think that Bernie might have been able to do it just because of the overwhelming amount of anti-establishment politics that exist right now in the United States. But
we just happen to be very young, and most people are too, but like Barry Goldwater, I think was his name, was the Trump equivalent, right, in the 60s. And then someone I actually know, Jesse Jackson.
Oh, God.
Yeah, he was the Bernie equivalent in many ways in the, I want to say the 80s. He ran for president. He actually won a state. obviously, Bernie got quite far. But you know, we've seen some analogs. Someone said that the Trump, it's never been this incendiary political campaign, and then someone quoted like Andrew Jackson, like talking about someone being a hermaphrodite, his opponent being a hermaphrodite.
Be fair, it was probably safer. You could probably use a lot of insults like that earlier on without them being inflammatory at all, right?
Probably, but yeah, with media now, there's a, you know, echo chamber, right? But. Mm-hmm. I think the, you know, it's sort of like, again, you know, for everyone to get up in arms about it and worried about it, I'd rather preach, like, I have, my brother plays League of Legends and World of Warcraft, and I joked with him that if on his computer screen, across the top of the screen, there was a scrolling ticker of physics or chemistry, he would have a PhD by now. Sure. And, you know, this idea that, you know, he needs to escape from reality by playing these video games, and I do it too. We all do it. Instead of improving himself, to me, that's sort of like the great tragedy of life is that we waste all of our time. And
I feel like you underrate personal happiness when you say that, though, right? I guess, like, to use the meme, I'm sure it's a Tumblr quote or some shit. Time spent having fun is never time wasted, or time wasted being happy isn't time wasted, like. I notice that, like, a lot of people will do that. A lot of people will say, like, I've spent, you know, 10,000 hours playing StarCraft or League. Imagine if I would have put that 10,000 hours into studying economics or studying some hard science, and, you know, I would be a PhD making, you know, so much money and all this shit. But I think it's a lot easier to go back in the past and say that and then kind of underrate, like, how much fun you had doing whatever. I guess this goes into, like, personal life philosophy more than anything else, but...
I know so many people that play these video games and they're not having fun. You know, they're sort of like... treading water. And,
oh, sure, for sure. But I mean, like, are they not having fun because they're playing video games, or is it because there are some other life things going on? And exactly. Even if the video games weren't there, they'd be wasting their time on something else.
That's exactly right. I mean, it's another problem in their life, and it doesn't have to be video games. It could be something like, you know, any other sort of activity that's sort of this vacant, watching TV or something like that. Watching sports, I think, is to be honest with you, is no different from video games, and it's to me symptomatic of mental distress. If you play video games for 10 hours a day, you have to see a psychologist.
Damn, dude.
there's something wrong with you. You might be this rare person that is having a lot of fun and is enjoying the game. But it's there's probably, and I'm to be totally upfront, I'm not a psychology expert at all. I am a psychiatric expert. But psychology is not, you know, my field. I've read a little Freud and that's about it. But in general, I don't think you have to be a psychology PhD to understand, like, clearly you're masking some major problem in your life. You're running from it. You're evading it. There's a huge issue with you in your life that, you know, you're basically transporting yourself into, whether it's, you know, forget the world of work, Azeroth. You're leaving Earth's problems and joining Azeroth because you can't handle Earth. And this notion that, no, I'm just trying to have fun. Well, I think that's a cop out. I mean, this idea that you're, you know, you really prefer the world of Azeroth to the world of Earth. And there are days where I'd rather be in Azeroth than Earth. That's for damn sure. There are days where, just like I'm sure your job, it's stressful. It sucks. I don't want to do that. And absolutely, there should be great outlets to blow off steam. And whether it's on Steam, I suppose, or other, you know, avenues. But when you start to get into this addiction and this sort of escapism, I think that is, you know, the gaming community, you know, sort of needs to talk about this a little bit more than it does. I mean, you should not be proud of yourself playing 10,000 hours of video game. I think
it depends on, for me personally, like, I don't view 10,000 hours into anything, I think, is more or less the equivalent, assuming that you are, I think that you are overrating the amount of time spent and underrating the damaging impacts on your life. Like, for instance, let's say that every weekend somebody does, like, a fucking 36-hour marathon, but then during the week he's got a healthy life, every other weekend he gets out and he sees his family, he's got a social life, he's got friends. Like, I don't think there's anything wrong with that, versus the person that, you know, right after coming home, doesn't shower for 3 or 4 days, gets on the computer and is angry the entire fucking time, you know, like, I feel like it's not so much the time spent, more as how do you spend the rest of your life that you're not playing games?
Sure. No, and there's no, you know, I'm not casting any judgment on anyone. I just think that...
But, like, I know what you mean. Like, I'll get in a game, and, like, 2 minutes in, some guy's already, like, super fucking pissed off. And it's like, why? You were playing video games, dog. Like, why are you already so mad? Like, why are you even here? Yeah.
No, I think it's okay. I mean, I got banned off Twitch for getting being too reactionary to user comments. I get very heated very quickly.
Well, being too reactionary, weren't you posting kids' phone numbers?
I don't remember, but I don't do things like that. No, 10,000 hours is 250 40-hour weeks. Mm-hmm. That is 4 years of a full-time game, you know, full-time job. And if I have anxiety, I don't talk about it a lot, but I have anxiety. I take medicine for it. I have no symptoms, which is great. Medicine works great. But there are people that can't cope with stress of life.
Sure.
And we all cope with it differently. And if you tap, so-called tap out after 12 hours of life, right, and you say, you know what, it's fucking 1 a.m. I've been literally working since 7 a.m. I'm ready to tap out. I want to play an hour of League. I want to drink a beer. I want a blowjob, and I'm done. That's fine. Like, you know, you have to psychologically, you just can't take that much damage, right, mentally.
Sure.
And maybe, God bless, maybe with the medicine especially, I can take a lot of damage. Some days I don't feel like taking any damage. But there are people that literally, I mean, I know a lot of them. They'd be in their late 20s, early 30s. They're living at home. They're not working. They're playing video games all day long, and they're sort of coasting from, maybe they'll have a job for a few weeks. They'll take a class here and there. They have no income. These are the kind of people that I think the gaming community needs to sort of look out for and say, look, you know, I play video games with you. I play Hearthstone with you here and there. You're always on. Like, what's up with your life? You know, can you, you know, maybe you need help. And I think that that's, you know, one of the reasons I actually do like Bernie, who's the only candidate to talk about mental health. And my company is still working on the first drug ever for suicidality. And it's a ketamine for treatment of resistant depression and suicidality. One of my family members actually has this illness. And, you know, in the gaming, video gaming is, I think, people who are so-called addicted to video games, I often think they have severe depression. And maybe I'm stereotyping, maybe I don't know what I'm talking about. It's pretty far afield from what I know. But I know games, I play a lot of video games, and I meet a lot of people who are truly depressed and need help. And I think, you know, I'm curious. I mean, you have a big stream. You know, how do you feel about mental health in gamers?
I mean, obviously, it's really, I can't diagnose somebody that I feel that way after one or two games, so it's hard for me to say it. But I mean, I agree with what you're saying in general, that there are people that use escapism in like really negative ways. I don't think that it's unique to video games. People do it with, you know, whether it's watching sports or watching TV or doing nothing or drugs. You know, marijuana is a popular for that kind of shit. Like, yeah, I think there's a lot of different ways that people do it. Yeah, I do agree that mental health isn't talked about much, really, in much of any place. I think that it's kind of sad that there are, like, I get this playing League. There are a lot of people that play games, and like I said, like, if I'm in a ranked game and some guy is, like, going off on the team, like, 3 minutes in, I have to wonder, like, why the fuck are you even playing this game right now? Like, this is supposed to be for fun, and, like, you're already upset.
Yeah, the episodic crazy, we all rage, right? We all go nuts sometimes on the games, and sometimes that's good. I worry about the kid that is just... I don't know. Maybe I'm too empathetic, but I meet people in these games that are just truly like miserable and their life sucks. And I just want to sort of grab them and shake them and say, like, you need help. Like, you need to go to therapy or something. Like, I've never actually been to therapy once in my life. A lot of people think that's desperately overdue. But regardless, just, I think, looking out for each other. So what's great about this gaming community, what's great about Twitch, and I wish I could be on it again, is that behind all the bullshit and the raging and all that shit, there's actually our communities of friends that, you know, people care about each other. And God forbid, sometimes we even really have this great affinity for each other. Some people I play League with in my community that they're like great friends now, and it's fun, it's wonderful. But, you know... I think that, you know, this issue of just sort of looking out for people's sort of mental health is one that I'm close to, and maybe I'm rambling, but it's just one of these things that I sort of notice it a lot, and just wish that, you know, we could all be better sort of to each other. And a big part of, you know, whether it's Twitch or League or anything else is trolling and getting on each other's nerves and poking fun at each other, and I'm the first to do it. But I'd also, you know, you get to make close friends with people. You get to know them sometimes better than a lot of your friends in the quote-unquote real world, or sometimes even more than your family, and you care about them. And when you see someone play video games 24/7, ostensibly, I think you sort of have a duty to say, are you really having fun, or... you okay?
Sure.
You know, I think that's something that we should all do.
I'm curious now, just because your entrance into celebrity status has been so much different than other people. Does it ever, and I'm not saying like, are you depressed tonight, but does it ever bother you when people say things personally, like personally targeted insults at you across social media or whatever, when you know that it's fucking wrong and stupid? Like, does that ever bother you? So I guess like I see something like you, and it's like, oh, Martin Shkreli, that fucking piece of shit that was denying cancer or AIDS treatment, HIV treatment to some people. Like, what a fucking piece of shit that guy is. I hope he gets fucking raped in prison. Like, when do you see shit like that? Does that bother you?
I'm probably the one person on the planet that doesn't bother. And it's just bizarre because for whatever reason, that stuff just floats over me, because I truly know that the person is coming from a place of ignorance.
Mm-hmm.
If there was a pharmaceutical executive that sat down and said, you know what, I know everything about pharma, just like Martin, and I really think this is wrong, and he was as vociferous as that, he was as intense as that, and was willing to sit down with me and be that intense and still feel that way afterwards, I actually would feel... feels bad, man. Is that a thing?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, no, I know what you mean.
Yeah, you know, but like for some, you know, internet geek to, you know, lash out at me like, what do I care? Like, great, man. You know, I'm clearly fulfilling something you want to yell at. And if I'm the symbol of capitalism that you hate, all right. You know, but if you actually spent not 10,000 hours, but you spent 100 hours reading about me and you still hate me, yeah, I would actually feel bad. If you spent 10 minutes, you know, or 5 minutes, you know, or 0 minutes, you spent 30 seconds, okay, great. You know, it's as valuable to me as making fun of my haircut. Like, it just doesn't bother me. You know, why should it? And I got the most scorn and hate out of a lot of people for a short period of time, or maybe a long period of time. And you know, I live my life exactly the same as before. And a lot of people find that remarkable. Like, in fact, in the WikiLeaks, I don't want to talk about myself, but in the WikiLeaks, the guy was surprised that after they targeted me, that I still didn't back down. They were like, why doesn't he get it? We're making, like, we're hurting him. He has to react to this. And it's like, nah, fuck you guys. Like, I'm not gonna stop because of you.
Do you feel like, in terms of everything that's happened, I'm largely ignorant of what you do professionally, like in any deep sense, but do you feel like that's damaged your ability to procure funding or patents or work in general in terms of what you do?
Yeah, usually. Yeah, definitely. You know, funding is always a weird world.
Mm-hmm.
My arrest was more impactful. The price increase itself, it hurt a little bit, but the defiant attitude and the sort of, you know, the way Wall Street is in general, this sort of hammer fell for all companies. So the entire pharma sort of world, sorry, some hiccups here.
Sure.
The pharma world is sort of will quote unquote never be the same. But for the last year since I did what I did, all of pharma has suffered dramatically. And it's not just me. There are some other people that did it too. And it just sort of is what it is. That will fade, right? That'll go away and we'll be fine. You know, I'll be fine. Even, you know, Michael Milken, who went to prison for a year, was one of the richest people in the world. He came out, he was fine. He made even more money. It's a lot about temperament, and people respect someone who won't, even if they get knocked down, they get back up.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, you know, that's sort of my personality for better or worse. There was a guy who I actually knew who got arrested. The next day he killed himself.
Yeah.
And that's how he reacted to virtually the same situation that I'm in. I've actually started a new company. I still have all my Turing stock that I'm excited about. Like, I'm even more sort of pumped up than I ever have been. Sometimes you need setbacks to motivate you to achieve more. I was actually kind of getting bored.
Sure.
At Turing with all my success, and I was just like, yeah, let me, you know.
Didn't know, like, how much, like, in terms of relationships, like, I know, like, in Hollywood, if shit like that goes down sometimes, like, with Mel Gibson, like, you're completely ostracized from everything and your life is fucking over, you know?
Yeah, no, you can definitely be blacklisted from something like Hollywood. I think in capitalism, for whatever reason, in business, I should say, like, just...
Do you think if somebody like the Washington Post, like, targeted you, like some guy at Gawker or whatever was like, I fucking hate Martin, I'm going to destroy him. If every time you tried to start like some new business relationship, if the Washington Post would have posted it, like, oh, look, like X Pharmaceutical now working with Martin Shkreli, we know who to go after. Do you think stuff like that would have had a more damaging impact? Or
I think that just, you know, in general, most investors are very laissez-faire and passive about this kind of thing.
Oh, don't buy into the social media bullshit hype.
Yeah, exactly. If it's a good idea, it's a good idea. You know, what do I care? And, you know, if it's going to make money, it's going to make money. And obviously they're going to weigh the kind of pros and cons. I mean, I'm starting the software company. People say, well, on one hand, he's probably going to get a lot of users because, you know, he's the guy. And then on the other hand, you know, he's going to have some issues with all the other shit. And you have to just weigh it on balance. And I think that, you know, it's – look, if you look at Mark Cuban, he was not arrested, but he was charged by the SEC for insider trading.
Mm-hmm.
He beat the charges, and I don't think anyone even thinks about, you know, his charges. People don't even remember them, really.
Maybe it's because he won. I don't know. When I feel like a lot of people have a different view of Martha Stewart now.
Yeah, no, it's definitely because he won.
Yeah.
definitely. But if you win and you beat the charges, you almost become invincible. like people look at you and they're like, oh, that's Mark Cuban. Like the one time the government tried to nail him for something that like you might perceive that everybody does, like he beat him and now he's even like almost untouchable status. And of course I'm going to try to beat the government over my charges. But I think that, you know, there is something about being a controversial personality business person like an Elon Musk or you know, someone like a Mark Cuban. And there's something about just like the most famous, the most successful pharma entrepreneur ever is a guy named Patrick Soon-Shiong. He owns the Lakers and the Dodgers, so he hasn't exactly gone out of his way to be quiet. Mm-hmm. But nobody knows who he is. He has like 1,000 Twitter followers. He's worth $10 billion. He does absolutely nothing that's provocative. And so this, you know, there's sort of this, he's richer than Elon Musk, Donald Trump, and Mark Cuban combined. Sure. And he's got, you know, 1/100th of the interest level, or 1,000th. And so, you know, it's all what you make of it. And again, I think more and more, I just sort of think, you know, life is short, you know, whether you make $100 million, $1 billion, or $1 trillion, like, nobody's going to give a fuck. And the people I respect are people like Descartes and Einstein, that we remember their names hundreds of years after they're dead, in the case of Descartes, at least.
Sure.
And, you know, Turing is who I named my company after. Like, we'll remember his name hundreds of years from now. No one's going to remember some dude who started some startup that got sold for a couple bit. Like, who gives a fuck? Like,
yeah, it's right. Not like that scientist dude who talked about, I should know the fucking name of the guy, that Chinese dude. I think he's Chinese. I talked about going to Mars, that, you know, 2,000 years from now, nobody's going to remember who won in the Middle East, but they will remember the first steps we take towards some kind of, you know, space program or whatnot. Sure.
Yeah, yeah. And so I think, like, again, the Turing, Einstein, Harambe, like, these are the iconic, you know, people that we'll remember for centuries. And I just think that, you know, if we stopped, and not every, look, I kind of get that not everyone's cut out to be Descartes, and by definition, there can only be one Descartes every 500 years, and the rest of us have to play StarCraft. And like the average guy playing StarCraft is not going to become Descartes. And, you know, we can't change that. And as much as I want to foist my interests on other people, like, oh, you should read, you should do JavaScript, you should read about math, like, yeah, it just kind of sucks for most people. And again, to cast that as a mental illness is, I think, very disparaging. So what I struggle with philosophically is just sort of like all the world, everything you look around, we're all wasting time and doing nothing of importance. And that's just 99.9% of all human activity is just pointless and stupid and wasteful. And can we build a life of enjoyment out of that? And as a big streamer, like, I think philosophically, it's a good question for you. Like, do you think you matter? Do you think your life matters? Do you think the things you do matter? What does matter even mean? Like, are you in a quest for self-enlightenment or just happiness? And what, you know, especially with respect to your stream, what can you say, you know, you're like, do you do this for voyeurism? Do you do this for your own benefit? Do you do this so that you can bring a smile to 4,000 people's faces? What's in it for you?
I guess, like, it sounds like we have very different personal views on what you should strive for personally. Like, it sounds to me like, it sounds like you care a lot about things like legacy or lasting impact, right? Is that fair to say?
Sure.
Yeah. I guess for me personally, maybe, I don't know, different upbringings going out, but like, I'm very big on personal happiness and personal satisfaction. If I personally feel happy, and as long as I'm not a detriment to society, then I'm happy to carry on. And that's kind of how I see things. I don't really have a desire to leave like a big legacy behind me. Not that there's anything bad or wrong about that, but just for me personally, as long as I personally feel content with myself, if I like myself and I'm happy with what I'm doing, then I'll carry on doing it, assuming I can continue to do it and make a living off of it and not be a detriment to society doing it.
I think probably the most well-adjusted attitude one can have. I mean, the people that are messianic, right? They think that they are really more important than they are. Those are people who probably do need some time in the psychiatrist's or psychologist's chair. The problem is that, you know, if you've been taught, I mean, again, this is sort of about me a little bit. If you've been told your whole life that you're different, you're special, you're
the American dream.
Or even before you're in the American dream, you're intellectually destined for success. Mm-hmm. You sort of sit there and say, okay, well, if I can figure out a math proof that nobody else in my entire state could, you know, wait a second. Do I now owe it to everyone else to do important shit? Or can I be in that personal happiness camp?
I mean, sounds like if you live your life the way, it sounds like you're setting yourself up more often than not for failure, right? Because not every single person is going to, discover some exceptional achievement. It seems like you're setting the bar really fucking high there, and you don't want to set it so high that, like, if you miss, you're fucked, right? You hate yourself.
And you're crushed emotionally, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I found that the greatest pleasures I've had in life are playing Gangplank in season one with my brother. Like,
sure.
It's fucking great, you know? That ulti, though. And, you know, building a billion-dollar company and taking it public, like, yeah, that's cool. But, like, pressing R button is as cool or as exciting. And
you're talking about Harambe on MSNBC or whatever the fuck.
Yeah, exactly. Like, those are the moments that, you know, when you look back at your life, you're going to say, yeah, that was fucking great.
What, if you don't mind me asking, and I don't know how much you're even able to comment, when you had to, like, testify before Congress, why was that even set up? Like, what was the point of all that? And I understand if you're not able
I love this one. So, I raised this drug price a lot, and then the House asked me to come
mm-hmm.
and talk. And what I learned a lot about at least a small part of politics. There's these committees. A lot of people don't know about these committees, but the Senate and the House actually do shit. They
have subcommittees that rule on different things. And
again, they also get information, and, you know, they have governance over some, like, things like the CIA, like that, and so forth. And there is this weird so-called oversight committee.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the most ridiculous concept, is that they just sort of, I don't know what they do. They kind of have
their oversight. They do everything, right?
Generic responsibility, exactly. And so anytime there's some outrage, they get to, public outrage, they get to call whoever it is to Washington and just basically berate them. And what's amazing about it, and I don't know if I should call you Destiny.
Steve is okay.
I feel like such an, yeah.
Yeah.
What's amazing about it, Steve, is that there's absolutely no interest in hearing what the person has to say. It is just a pinata. And I'm sitting there like, look, I'll tell you guys everything you fucking need to know about fixing pharmaceuticals in the U.S. No fucking problem. Like, I made my money. You know, what the fuck do I care? I'm smart. I'll keep making money no matter what. You can change the mousetrap and I'll still, you know, figure it out. That's because, you know, that's what I do. I'm good at it. And you can change the stupid law that I loophole that I abused, and I'll find the next one and the next one and the next one. And you can keep dragging me down here and I'll just keep making money. But it's about self-aggrandizing. The people that lobbed these questions at me, I told them in advance that I would take the Fifth Amendment.
Yeah, that's what was so confusing to me. I figure you obviously communicate ahead of time, and it all seemed to be like big political theater. Like, all of these oversight committees seem to be, you know, they did it with Hillary too.
It's absurd. I mean, you know what? The reason that they do it is the number one cost for any politician is media buys, right?
Mm-hmm.
And getting a free media buy from your own job, you can't pass that opportunity up. It's like equivalent of getting $1 million donation, nonpartisan. You know, it's your job to grill people. You're going to grill them. And a guy is trying to skate out of it by taking the Fifth. No. Come on down. I'm going to grill you. The Senate had more honesty than that. They said, oh, if you're going to take the Fifth, don't come. And because, you know, we'll just excuse you after a minute. But the House of Representatives, which is often seen as, you know, the less important Senate, you know, they were so fixated on getting their pound of free media exposure, which nobody had a good enough line of questioning that they got too much traction. Trey Gowdy asked me if it was the Wu-Tang Clan that I was affiliated with. That got him a little press.
Sure.
So it's just getting your face. Like, people vote for, oh yeah, it's Trey Gowdy, I love that guy, I'm gonna vote for him. Like, it to me, it's like so ridiculous that that's the game you have to play to be a politician. Whether it's, you know, I can say as many curses as I want on this.
Oh yeah, I don't give a fuck.
Yeah, whether it's sucking dick for, you know, Boeing or Lehman Brothers or Citigroup or Walmart's, you know, super PAC money, or whatever money.
or, you know, begging that you get, you know, a picture with whatever, whoever people are angry at today. Politics is just a, you know, it's just such a silly game at the end of the day that, like, it has nothing to do with actual policy and things like that, that it should. You know, it's sort of, you know, it really gave me a glimpse into how fake it all was. Because I told these guys, I said, why don't you just call? Like, if you want to talk about drugs and how to fix drugs, just fucking call me, bro. Like, I take phone calls from YouTube all day.
But they were looking, they wanted to grandstand and make you look like literal Hitler, and they wanted to be the Jesus savior to come in and demonize the evil dude. Yeah.
When you absolutely don't give a fuck about the policy itself, and all you care about
is being self-righteous as fuck.
Yourself, yeah. It's like, well, I'm sorry, but you're, you know, you deserve to be smirked at because, you know, it's a mockery. Like, my phone number, I still have not gotten one fucking phone call from one of these guys. I know every secret loophole of the drug industry that I'll absolutely help them close. If they cared about drug prices and they cared about, you know, making a fair system, they'd call me, the greatest abuser of them possible, and just be like, hey, Martin, what should we do to fix our country? And I'd be like, yeah, bro, here, do this, do that. It'd be good, bro. But, you know, they don't want that. It's about getting reelected. It's about, you know, being comfortable. They don't actually care about American people. So to me, that's like a very, you know, transparent and pathetic kind of thing. Like, if Hillary Clinton was so damn concerned about my drug prices, listen, if Hillary Clinton called me, I'm going to pick up the fucking phone and show her a lot of respect, right? Because she's an important person. But she didn't do that. Instead, she fucking sent a tweet that 12 people, you know, wrote together. And it's like, all right, you don't care. I don't want to be your political pawn.
Yeah, it's all about pandering, sure.
Yeah, and so I think that my experience is probably the same experience as everyone else. And, you know, if all politics is a meta, you know, it's a meta game, like, how, you know, why would anyone want to be involved in that? Like, why do we care about it? Like, it's just a meta. Like, we think the game is about, you know, last hitting, if you will, but it's really about team comp or whatever it is. And it's like everyone's sitting there focused on the last hitting when the whole game is decided by team comp or whatever it might be.
Yeah, it's the same thing we talked about with Bernie, where Bernie went in and thought that if he could get the support of the people and the backing of the people and all of that without playing the actual game itself, that he could do it. But the DNC and superdelegates and everything had him fucked from the very start because he never wanted to actually play the game that was being played, right?
Yeah. So, like, again, you know, my reaction to it is just let me, you know what, you know, I'm out, you know, I don't want to deal with these idiots. And, you know, one of Hillary Clinton's strongest supporters was a guy named Michael Steinhardt. And there was a big, he was a huge hedge fund guy, and I looked up to him. Mm-hmm. And he's from Brooklyn, where I grew up. And he wrote a book. He wrote an autobiography called No Bull. And he basically owned the Clintons for most of the 80s and 90s. And he got this guy pardoned. Mark Rich was his name. Mm-hmm. Mark Rich traded oil with Iran or somebody that he shouldn't have traded oil with. Got arrested. He fled to Switzerland. And Steinhardt got him pardoned. And Denise Rich spent her time at the White House as a quote-unquote special advisor to Bill Clinton. Denise Rich is also extremely attractive at the time. So you can put one and one together on that one. And Steinhardt wrote in his book that he quit politics because it was so disgusting, the pay-for-play. This is in the 80s and 90s with the Clintons. And he was the head of the Democratic Senatorial Campaign Committee and all these other things that I aspire to say, yeah, I want to join all this stuff. And he was so disgusted with it, he quit, and he's not giving any money to any politicians anymore. Steinhardt started the famous Israeli thing called, I don't know if you've heard of it, called Birthright?
No.
Oh, okay. You're not Jewish?
No. I'm not very Jewish at all.
Okay. So he funded trips to basically anyone from the U.S. can go to Israel. If you're Jewish, you can go to Israel and visit your sort of homeland, if you will. And this idea that sorry, I just want to see the reaction from these people. So Steinhardt is this impeccable financier and philanthropist. He created a school here in New York, NYU's School of Education is named after him. And he created this entire big thing. At least we have a big Jewish community here in New York. Mm-hmm. It's very big in New York. this idea of birthright, where you could just go to Israel, spend 2 weeks in Israel, chilling, basically, on Michael Steinhardt's dime. Thousands and thousands of people have taken him up on it. I'm not Jewish, otherwise I would have done it myself. But, you know, this is a guy who was really the puppet master of everyone. And he basically said, you know, I just can't deal. You know, this is too dirty.
Yeah, it's like a totally separate world, it seems.
I have ethics. Like, I just can't, like, having Hillary Clinton in my back pocket makes me feel dirty, and I just don't like that.
Here's a very weird tangentially related question. How do you feel about, like, and this is very loosely, like, Trump's campaign's affiliations with, like, Russian entities, like the whole Paul Manafort stuff and everything? Do you think there was ever anything there, or?
Yeah, I think I think it's sort of Mount Rushmore molehill. I don't think he's, I mean, it's sort of like anything else. Like, if they're hacking Hillary Clinton, mm-hmm. All right, I'll take it, you know? You're not gonna, you know, thumb your nose at him. I don't think he's got a secret, you know, some secret Russian connection. I think he's just...
Why won't he release his taxes? It seems like a pretty...
good question. I don't think it has anything to do with Russia. I think it basically is going to show
like
that...
Like no charitable contributions or something, or avoiding taxes?
He's a scumbag. It's going to show that he didn't make that much money. He didn't pay anything in taxes. And he's just kind of a shyster.
Yeah, I feel like, because he seems to be okay with saying that he abused loopholes, which is fine. I think that he can make that argument. If any politician could, it's fucking him. Yeah, but it seems so bizarre to me that he wouldn't just, like, why would you draw that onto yourself?
I know a lot of people like that. My tax return, I just filed it. So I made $26 million last year in mm-hmm. realized gains. And... we got all these deductions down, and it's a different number because of these different bases. So, I mean, I technically made $17 million. The gross number was higher after deductions and all these things. I think my tax bill is like $2 million or something. Mm-hmm. And that's my tax returns, and I'm not a politician and whatever.
Fuck, so it's like a net less than 10% effective rate?
No. Because the deductions... No. My rate's insane.
Okay.
My gross trading income, like, so I didn't have any W-2 income. I don't make salary. So the only gains I have are stock trading. So I stock traded and made, I was like $24 million, something like that. And then after all these deductions, the net taxable number was like, I don't know, 8. So I got a lot of great deductions. And then my tax bill is like 3 or 4 or something like that.
Gotcha. Okay.
It's like 50% roughly. But I found these wonderful deductions that I never took in the past, which was, thank God. Otherwise, my tax bill would have been $10 million mm-hmm. or more. But the funny thing is, I made $26 million trading last year. That's like 1% of my average actual business. That's me trading my stock account the same way you might trade your stock account on the side. Sure. My main business was starting a drug company. So this idea – well, I'm including state. So if I include state taxes, it adds another $1 million. Mm-hmm. So if you just do federal, it's sort of like 2 to 3. And if you add the state, it's like 3 to – you know, another $1 million just makes it 3 to 4. Trust me, I work on these numbers for the last 3 weeks.
Sure.
I'm happy that they're done. Someone's like, oh, first you said 2 million, then you said 3. Suck a dick. So anyway, the point I'm making is that my actual business was creating Turing from scratch, buying Daraprim, raising its price, creating a business. Until I sell that business, it doesn't appear in my income tax. It's nothing to do with it. So my guess is Donald Trump in 2015 or 2014, he probably made like $20 million or something. Mm-hmm. Something like, for him, it looks small.
Yeah.
And if he released that, everyone would be like, whoa, aren't you a billionaire? Like, what the fuck?
Yeah, I kind of wonder sometimes how much he might over-exaggerate some things, too. There was, I wish I had the link to it. You could probably Google it pretty easily. There was some court case where he had to defend his assets or something, but he actually had to go to court to do it. So, obviously, you know, there's discovery and all of that shit, and so they had actual numbers, and Trump would exaggerate every fucking figure so much and would have to dial it back so much, like, when they actually got into questioning. Like, It was really cringeworthy. Something like somebody would ask him, like, how much was that advertising deal sold for? And he'd be like, $5 million. And I'd be like, wasn't it only like $250,000? And he's like, yeah, but we got like $4.75 million off of, like, you know, the additional thing it generated. It's like, okay, well, that was, you know, like.
To be fair, businesses, that's often the case in business, right?
Yeah, I mean, sure.
Two ways of looking at it. And in fact, that's a lot of my criminal cases about. Mm-hmm. It's about, like, well, are you taking the one way of looking at it, or are you taking another way of looking at it? And both are reasonable. It's just a matter of, you know, how much of a, you know, how much you want to sort of one way or the other. And the problem, the point I'm making, and it's subtle and maybe you just don't care. I don't think it went over your head. You're obviously a smart guy. The point is that, like, in any given year, your tax return does not necessarily reflect your business activity.
Oh, yeah, so, sure.
You know, if you sold a couple of buildings, Trump might have a tax return in 2018 that's like $700 million. But if he's not selling buildings, he could still be making hundreds of millions of dollars of properties that are appreciating. But until you sell, the IRS doesn't see the quiet appreciation because you don't pay taxes until you're out. You sell your business, okay, now you got to pay your tax. But if you're just quietly letting a building go from, okay, it's worth $600 million, now it's worth $800 million, now it's worth $1.5 billion, like, none of that income is taxable because it's not taxable until you realize that income. And then, so my guess is Trump's last couple of years were just quiet years. And I'd almost prefer some quiet years right now myself. You know, quiet years are nice. But when you actually sell, that's when you have to recognize the tax and so forth. I think he's almost egotistically embarrassed that he might have had a really quiet year where his income was like, yeah, you know, $10 million, and I donated like $75 million. And then Clinton's going to say, okay, so you made $10 million and you gave away $75 million, or you have deductions for $75 million. What kind of businessman are you? I thought you were a successful billionaire. You know, and he's going to be embarrassed, and Mark Cuban's going to get on his case for not being that rich.
Yeah,
and,
or Warren Buffett, or, yeah.
Yeah, and so like, $10 million, how did you, you know, and then he's going to have to say, oh, no, I'm still worth $10 billion.
Yeah, and you don't want to be, you just don't even want to take up the argument of defending, why did I only make $10 million when I've said I'm worth $10 billion? Like, you don't even want to be in that position, because you've already lost at that point. Even,
yeah, exactly, you lost, yeah. You totally lost, yeah. So what do you play?
League of Legends. I used to be a semi-professional StarCraft player, but now I play League.
What's your ELO?
I finally made it back into Diamond 5.
Cool. I was Diamond 5. It's a little bit boosted. I had a challenger team. Some dickhead said that I I was bad for the esports scene and I like didn't pay people.
Okay.
Last year, I paid players $1 million. $1 million. I don't think there's an org that has paid players more.
Yeah, I was gonna say the average salary for esports shit is like fucking $2,000 a month. So I have like a really hard time believing that anybody with a reasonable amount of money would be stiffing people here. But
I paid players way too much.
What did you? I'm sorry, I'm actually totally ignorant of this. Did you own like a team or?
Yeah, I tried to own a team briefly, and I wouldn't say I went ham, but look, I deducted all of it, which is great.
Uh-huh.
I was wondering if some of you are wondering why why I went from 20-something in gains to a $2 million, $3 million, $4 million tax bill. That's how. Mm-hmm. I paid lawyers $4 million and all these other deductions. But we had a Dota team for like 2 seconds.
Gotcha.
But most of our team was League, and it was a challenger team. I paid a lot of them were my friends. They weren't originally friends, they became friends. People like, I don't know if you know who Billy Boss is, like, they're not like pros. We got Steelback, we got a couple of guys like that. We, in many ways, we just pick guys on the challenger, like, just in the challenger rankings.
Yeah, people maybe that with the right push could go pro.
Right. You're being generous. The wrong way to start the esports team is to go to the challenger list.
Sure.
Terrible, terrible way to do it. Like, oh, you're top five challenger. You gotta be, you gotta be in the list. Steelback was our most famous and best player. He was fantastic.
Looking at the landscape, you're never making that money back. I'm sure you know that, right?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Why the angel investing? What do you just like Dota? Or?
So I mentioned my brother who is sort of has this unique sort of condition.
Mm-hmm.
I don't play Dota. I played it once or twice. I play League. There's this really hot girl I play Dota with sometimes. I do it completely to humor her. I love League of Legends. My brother loves League of Legends. I thought he'd get more of a kick out of me sort of doing this team stuff than him. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, than he did. He didn't really care, to be honest.
Okay.
Yeah, which is unfortunate because my $1 million is gone. But, you know, so I paid guys like Steelback. I mean, I can look up right now how much I paid Steelback if you want to, you're curious.
I mean, if you want to, sure.
Yeah. I look back on it as it was stupid. Let's see here. Okay. So directly, because we may have paid them indirectly as well. But I directly transferred to Steelback from my PayPal.
Hey, another guy that holds a lot of money in PayPal. I don't feel bad now. Sorry.
At least $53,000. Let me keep going here. There's more payments. And I'm a little, something's weird about me. I start to get drunk off one beer. So I'm sifting through this PayPal. It's also 1 a.m. At least $53,000 last year. And, oh, wait, there's more. $56,000. For one, I mean, he played like 3 months with us.
Nice.
So think about that. And let me pick someone like your average sort of challenger noob.
Are there no kind of negative impacts drinking while on any kind of anxiety medication or anything?
Not this one. I don't take Xanax or anything.
Okay, gotcha.
But like, it was just inordinately generous. So when I see that, like, some guy sued me, this guy, Sean Thani, he was Curry Shot. I don't know if you know who he is.
Not sure.
I don't even know where he was our coach. He did fucking terribly. I mean, he was a trash coach. Trying to find the sum here. $32,000 at least. I think there's more though. There's far more. Here's another $6,000, $38,000. This guy lost our series. I mean, he played terribly. We played. So just trying to make sure that I'm not missing any. Yep, here's another. Okay. So the guy got $45,000 to be our League of Legends coach for our challenger team. We failed to qualify. I think there's more payments that I'm missing here. Mm-hmm. And he sues us. You know, obviously, look, if you fail to honor your contractual agreement, you fail to honor your contractual agreement, you should be sued. But I can't imagine we failed to honor our contractual agreement. Furthermore, the company failed to honor its contractual agreement, partially because the company is no longer investors don't want to keep losing fortunes in it, right? So you enter a contract with a company, not with me, right?
Oh, he's suing you personally?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. That's good.
Okay. We had a jungler named Liquid Inori who is, again, on the challenger list. We hired him. He disappointed us. All these people are wonderful people. I'm not gonna, throw them under the bus. But a lot of these guys they kind of didn't cut the cheese in the real, kind of.
Was your team like? Was it an actual? You filed the papers for an actual organization?
Yeah, we talked to the Riot people. I forgot what his name is. The official guy. Yeah.
How does he even have a lawyer that will bring charges to you? Does he figure you'll just settle it because you don't want to deal with it, or what?
I mean, you can sue the company all you want. The company doesn't have any money. I mean,
yeah, but you said he's suing you personally.
He's not gonna win. I mean,
yeah. You ever get triggered as fuck when all the Occupy Wall Street people talk about how businesses aren't allowed to be people and you should be able to sue people directly if their business fucks up?
I don't know that that's crazy.
You don't think that's crazy?
So I'll tell you this. The reason I'm gonna win my case against the government is that I had hedge funds. Occasionally, depends on your perspective, I dispute the government's allegations, but the government's allegation is that I lost a lot of people money trading stocks, and then I went out of my pocket and gave them money back.
And then lied about where it came from? Is that?
No.
Oh, okay. That's what the charge I thought was.
It's very subtle. It's at the heart of my hedge fund. I lost money trading stocks.
Uh-huh.
And then I went out of my own pocket and supplemented the fund to make the fund whole.
Sure.
There's that. You're talking about something that's a little bit different.
Okay.
and certainly out there important. When hedge fund
No, you're not going to say anything that's going to get like your whole case fucked on my stream. Okay, I don't want to get fucking. I don't know if you have like Hillary drones working for you that are going to assassinate me if you say some stupid shit. Okay, all right.
Yeah, no, I think I'll be okay. But
okay.
The weird thing is like I actually went out of my pocket to give my hedge fund investors money and properties that would make them whole, and in essence, I felt a personal responsibility for these investors. Your average investor. Your average hedge fund executive would say, hey, lost money, go fuck yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And literally like, easy come, easy go, sometimes you win, sometimes you lose, not my problem. I think personal responsibility in business is actually really important. And that's why Turing did what it did to raise prices, because it's like, look, I'm gonna bring this business to success one way or the fucking other. Like, that's why people invest with me, because like, I'm gonna carry you on my back. And it might be pretty and it might be ugly, but I'm going to get you to the finish line and we're going to kill the Nexus. And I don't know how we're going to do it, but we're going to do it. It might be a clean win. It might be really ugly.
So is that in and of itself? Let's say I run a hedge fund and then I run it into the ground, or I don't run it into the ground, but it's a really bad fucking year even compared to the market. So sure. I decide to supplement the hedge fund with personal income. Is that in and of itself illegal?
I don't think it is.
Okay, never mind. Okay.
Because if you think about it, it's like... the most fucking benevolent thing you can do, like, to...
Well, I thought, like, isn't the argument that... So let's say that I run a hedge fund, and let's say
I'll tell you what their argument is.
Uh-huh.
It's easier this way. If you do that, first, you're the most benevolent person in the world. To call you a fraudster, you just did anti-fraud, right?
Well, but couldn't you claim it's advertising? Like, yo, look, like, my hedge fund made 15% last year, but you actually supplement it with your own income.
As long as they actually got the 15%. Who cares?
Well, but if other people invest in you expecting that same return, don't you kind of get like pyramid scheme in there?
As long as you can provide it in good faith, right? I didn't do that assuming that I couldn't do it, right? If you tell people, I'll guarantee you 15% forever, clearly you couldn't do that for... you'd have people lining up saying, okay, I have $100 billion. You can guarantee me 15% forever? Where's the $15 billion going to come from?
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, that's unrealistic. I had a small hedge fund. So for me, it was reasonable to say, no, I can prevent your losses because I care about my clients and I'm not going to let you lose. If the hedge fund became a billion-dollar hedge fund, no, I can't I can't backstop you guys. Come on.
Sure.
I don't have that kind of money. But for a small fund, sure. The government's problem is that I told the investors that they were not losing money when they lost money in the trading aspect of the fund.
Gotcha.
We made bad trades. They sucked. Mea culpa. I take responsibility. But I also said, you know what? Those bad trades, I don't think they basically exist because I'm going to replenish the fund with money. And so that worked. I had happy clients. And when I started my drug company, people put $100 million in there.
Mm-hmm.
They knew that there was investigations. They knew that there was the SEC and others poking around. They still invested $100 million in a brand new drug company. It was the fifth largest ever in the history of drugs. So people were pretty pumped about my newest company, even though there were allegations and potential risks. But they knew that, you know, I'm going to actually care for you because that's the personality that I have, and I put my own money in and so forth. So.
Which I guess, like, in looking,
I think you should be responsible for your business. Maybe not to the penny, and not to the jilted guy that, you know, is complaining about his last $2,000 being overpaid as a lead coach. Like,
yeah, I was gonna say, like, the big reason why I feel like that's kind of a weird thing is that you know that you have more personal capital available to you than 99.9999% of people in the history of the earth, right? But like, to the average person, let's say that they want to do a startup, so they open a small shop to do, say, carpet cleaning or any kind of blue collar work, some machine work or whatever, that if that business were to fail, the idea that you could go back on them and get every single asset they own, like including a personal house, personal car, like,
that's great. That's crazy. But if you say, you know, Steve, I want you to invest in my hedge fund, and you say, you know what, I've got $100,000 saved up, I'm gonna give you $50,000, and I say, great, I'm gonna take good care of it. 2 seconds later, it's gone, and I have $100 million or $500 million, and you say, hey, Martin, what the fuck happened? And I say, yeah, tough luck.
Yeah, I agree that, like, if you do, yeah, I mean, there should be some accountability, obviously, but the idea, I feel like the liability extension is, like, one of the cornerstones of American business. Like, I feel like the amount of people willing to invest money or take a risk on something, knowing that the liability could come back to them, would severely diminish, like...
I mean, you're absolutely right. Yeah. I just think that there's honor, and, sure, you know, kind of, in hedge funds especially, there's a lot of honor, and I just can't... If you want repeat investors, especially if you want a good reputation, you know, you don't want people to just, you know, kind of get taken to the cleaners. I mean,
yeah, because then no one's going to invest in you again. Sure.
Yeah, and it feels bad, man. I mean, someone invests with you, and there's hedge fund managers, I'm sure you know this, that they get paid 1% no matter what. So if you gave them $1 billion, they could literally hire a monkey to throw darts at the wall. They'll get $10 million. The clients can lose their shirts. They still make $10 million. Mm-hmm. And it's really makes no sense to me, because you should never be in a position where the client loses and you win. And I've lived my life by that. And I think this will be relatively – it's hard to say that any acquittal is easy, because the government seems to win 90% of all criminal cases. But I think this will be an easy acquittal, because if you look at my numbers – I made $16,000 as my salary at my hedge fund over 5 years. I don't think there's, like, anyone that could live on that kind of money. And in fact, the SEC asked me to my face. They said, "How did you live?" I said, "I live with my parents." You know, I made ends meet. Like, I struggled, and then I ended up succeeding. It was fucking great. But, you know, like, it's like what we're talking about. For me, we do have different philosophies in life, but from my perspective, life is about great moments, and that moment doesn't have to be, you know, making a zillion trillion dollars or fucking a supermodel. Mm-hmm. That can be as fun as the first time you landed a gangplank cult with your brother in season one of League, and that magic that you'll never get back in season six. Or, you know, the overcoming, in my case, overcoming that adversity and actually having a modestly successful business despite having a really kind of bad run of luck or whatever. And so I'm not as addicted to maybe as, like, success as you might think, and legacy and stuff like that. I idolize someone like a Descartes, sure, but I have no false assumption that I could ever be someone like that.
Gotcha. Real fast, I'm sorry, can you give me the link to your stream in Skype, where you are on YouTube?
So you've been very generous with your time, and you know, I appreciate that.
No, I mean, your time is worth a lot more than mine is.
I don't know about that.
I'm pretty sure it is.
No, I've enjoyed the conversation, and you know, I'd be happy to do it on a once a month or once whatever, however much you'd like.
Yeah, sure. I got a dude telling me that I can't stream the combo, so I'm just cutting my stream. But I'll give them a YouTube link if.
Okay. Yeah, I had my first like that.
Gotcha. Real fast. I'm sorry. Can you give me the link to your stream in Skype, where you are on YouTube?
So you've been very generous with your time, and you know, I appreciate that.
No, I mean, your time is worth a lot more than mine is.
I don't know about that.
I'm pretty sure it is.
No, I've enjoyed the conversation, and you know, I'd be happy to do it on a once a month or once whatever, however much you'd like.
Yeah, sure. I got a dude telling me that I can't stream the combo, so I'm just cutting my stream. But I'll give them a YouTube link if.
Okay. Yeah, I had my first Democratic friend ever.
Oh, fuck. Because I guess in finance and everything, most of those guys would tend to be right-leaning.
I'm joking, but no, they actually, believe it or not, are more liberal than anyone else. But I'm just being jovial about it. My first Hillary supporter friend ever. No, I don't.
I'm not. Please don't call me a Hillary supporter.
please don't call me a Trump supporter.
Okay. So I'm curious, digging into this, if you have to go, whatever, let me know too. Do you think that for, like, the housing crisis, do you think that somebody should have caught more flack for that? Or was that just a big meme or what?
I don't know if it was a big meme.
Because it seems like it's the ultimate exercise in passing the buck, right? Like, well, I don't know why the credit rating agencies rated it, you know, as AAA. And, well, I don't know why they presented it as to as good. I don't know why these, you know, like, it seems like everybody passed the buck to everybody.
I've got a good answer for that. There are several lies that are basically propagated about business and finance. The first is that stocks go up over the long run. It's the biggest lie that's ever been told.
Why do you say that?
Exactly. We all believe it. It makes
I mean, because it's been true historically, right?
it's been true for the United States of America.
Yeah, fuck yeah, that's the country we live in.
Well, what if you live in any other country?
We're hasn't the entire world more or less moved towards a direction of wealth? Like, especially if you look at booming places like China and India, isn't that kind of the trend?
It's a couple of lucky countries.
Mm-hmm.
We are a lucky country. And to assume that we will continue to be lucky is a fallacy in and of itself. It's a selection bias. It's confirmation bias. The United States stock market has returned 2% above inflation and taxes a year. That is not worth it to risk potentially the possibility that, God forbid, we are actually not special and that we will revert to mean and that we will have problems that have not happened yet. And if you look at Japan or there was a country called the USSR that was – they thought they were as good as America. They thought they were better. They had to totally tear down their entire stock market. Everyone lost every penny. I don't think that's going to happen to us.
Mm-hmm.
But the point is that there's this idea that, like, there's no way we'll revert to mean. There's no way that we'll not be the best. And first of all, what is the best? The stock market's only gone up 2% a year.
Sure, but I guess like a lot of people would point to, I have to resort to very general arguments, so I'm sure you know this more than me, but like I hear people more saying that, like, because a lot of people get really ass-pained when we compare our growth to like China, and they're like, why can't we grow like China? Isn't the argument there that the United States has peaked its like prime growth and now we're just kind of holding stable and there is no more like explosion that can really happen realistically?
Well, a lot of people in the economic community feel that China numbers are fake.
Sure.
You know, like a lot of things about China,
sure.
Those numbers are basically fraudulent, made up.
Well, but I mean, they have become more wealthy, right? Like you can see that in external investments as well, like over time. Sure.
It's been a great, great time for China. It's been a great time for us. I mean, at the end of the day, there's been a lot of great economic growth. But my point is that, like, if you really take a hard look at the numbers, like, you don't get rich just buying stocks and sitting on your ass and doing nothing. It, first of all, wouldn't make sense. Like, there's the concept that that arbitrage opportunity would be arbitraged. People would just, you know, get out of it and reprice it. And there'd be no room at the table for you. There's no trough, feeding trough, that you could just make free money. It makes no fucking sense. And, you know, I think that, you know, this idea that, you know, there is this historical small, in my opinion, if you adjust for taxes, which we have high taxes, and if you adjust for inflation, where we've had high inflation, I'm not sure you made much money, and you're picking the best fucking country ever. And my numbers, I calculated them on a live stream, are 2%. 2% a year for the best country ever. That is not worth betting that we'll continue to be the greatest country ever. Because again, to your point, we're a much bigger country than before. It's harder to grow. There's a lot of other little things that sort of creep in here. We have more bureaucracy, we have more, et cetera. And technology makes things more uncertain. Maybe China's going to be the new leader. Maybe India's going to be the new leader. Maybe it's going to be us. Who knows? But to bet that American stocks are good for you personally is insane. So your question was about housing. I feel it's the same way. People assume real estate will go up. It makes no sense. It absolutely makes no sense. This idea that real estate is an asset class that we should rest easy and the American dream is to own a home and all this stuff. I rent my apartment. I think real estate is a farce. I'm not so crazy about it that I'll short real estate and like the people that did in the housing crisis, but I think that real estate is more of a there's sort of this a propagated fallacy that we've all bought into, and being independent minded and saying, you know what, I don't fucking trust this. You know, why is my little hole in the sky going to be worth more than anyone else's?
Sure. Wasn't the like the housing crisis, though, wasn't that more the fact that Wall Street via like MSBs and CDOs connected international markets to housing? Wasn't that where the big push for the increase in value of housing and everything kind of came from?
To be honest with you, I think it was more about just Americans, big and small, funds and individual families, thinking that, you know what, we're going to make a lot of money just buying a house.
Mm-hmm.
And the crazy thing about America is there's a lot of land here. And with the internet, there's this connection that you don't need to be in New York City anymore to be connected to the world. You don't need to be in San Francisco. You don't need to be in LA. You can be in anywhere in the country
I mean, a lot of people kind of congregate, right? I mean, like, fucking living in San Francisco is expensive as fuck, and it seems like for tech, you kind of have to.
I know a top developer who lives in Wisconsin. He works at a San Francisco-based company, and I think the internet...
It's becoming less necessary, for sure.
Yeah, that's all I'm saying, is on the margin, the internet has provided us an ability to be less... We need to be in cities less and congregate around cities a little bit less than before. If anyone, Warren Buffett's taught us that, you know, where you're at doesn't really matter that much.
Well, what are you dissing on Omaha? It's where I live, dog.
Well, I love him. You know, I'm a Buffettologist. I mean, he's my hero. But, you know, my point is he's proven that you don't need to be in New York to be. He's the greatest investor who's ever lived.
Sure. So if you don't believe in the long-term viability of the market, which is something that, like, economists hold as fucking sacred, right? The 7 to 10% returns every year guaranteed over time.
7 to 10, yeah, that'd be great.
So before the misery index, right? So if you don't believe in the long-term viability of the market, just as a general question, I'm not asking for fucking trading tips. Yeah. Where for, like, the average person, like, where do you think that money should be going to? You're saving money long-term?
I've told everyone that all they should really be doing is focused on their, you know, I've sort of dovetailed this with gaming earlier. Mm-hmm. Should be focused on their career. You know, make as much goddamn money as you can doing what you do. If you're a construction guy, start a construction company. Your dream should be, you know, maybe I can start a construction company and make millions of dollars, you know, and, you know, work your way up, you know. But you cannot, you know, in your spare time make money in the markets, because there's guys like me ready to eat your lunch 24/7. There's billions of people like me ready to kick your ass. You know, if I went to Brock Lesnar and I said, let's do an MMA match for $10 million, you'd call me an idiot and you'd be right. But people do that in the stock market every day. They sign up and say, yeah, well, you know what? I'm going to take on Brock Lesnar and win. No, you're not. You're going to lose to Steve Cohen, to George Soros, to Michael Steinhardt, to Julian Robertson, to me. We're going to kick your ass, and you're going to give me your money because you're an idiot. And instead of focusing on what you do for a living, you're focused on what, playing a game with me on investing? No, you're going to lose. You know, why would you play a diamond challenger guy? You know, you're bronze. The fuck out of here. Go focus on what you're challenger at, and you'll win. Warren Buffett was asked this question: how do you beat Bobby Fischer in chess? This is when Bobby Fischer was still alive.
Sure.
And he didn't know the answer, and the guy said, get him to play anything other than chess. And if you just focus on your career and your advancements, and, you know, the greatest fortunes, some of them are made on somewhat silly things. I mean, the gal Tory Burch, her clothing line, she's worth, you know, she's one of the richest women in the world. Oprah. I mean, these are people, you don't have to be a genius to be rich. Just focus. And
don't you think, like, isn't it a little bit disingenuous, though, to kind of imply that every person could be successful owning a business?
Not every person could be successful. You're right. But it's the same way not every person can be successful at investing. I mean, there's people that try their ass off investing.
Sure. When I was talking about investing, I mean, like, buying ETFs or just investing in, like, really big funds, not buying stocks or whatever.
You're basically gambling, I mean, in my opinion. I don't think there's any positive expected return. You're praying that things turn out well for you. They may not, but to assign any skill to it or any expected positive return, the world is a cruel and unusual place. Mm-hmm. If there was any natural positive return, it'd be eaten by somebody else.
Looking to arbitrage it or whatever, sure.
Yeah, I mean, I would fucking take it from you. I mean, it's my job. You know, it's what I get paid for. Because people are willing to pay me 20% or more, whereas, you know, who's managing your money? And it's just sort of, there are moments where you get fooled into thinking that, like, oh yeah, it's free money out there. Like, in the 90s, or something, the markets did so well that you just kind of expected good returns. And, you know, then you get in this freezing environment where if you invested in 2000, you're just now getting your money back. Just now.
Yeah, but I mean, people always talk about different time horizons, right? Like 5-10 years is never the horizon you're looking at, because obviously you could get fucked depending on when you enter the market.
That's a long horizon, 5 or 10 years.
No way. You live 70, 80 years, right?
Yeah, but what do you need that money and all this? I mean,
liquidity, then don't invest in fucking stocks. I know what you mean. Yeah, I know what you mean.
Also, this, like, if you put $5,000 every year into the markets for the rest of your life, you are making a bet that America will, I'm being a little flamboyant here for a reason, will still exist in 50 or 100 years. But remember, people in the USSR said, that's crazy, Martin. What would you do? Would you still exist?
You don't think there are a few more, like, if you look at something like our national debt and our trade deficits, don't you think we have Don't you think we have like a little bit stronger of a presence in the world than like the USSR did, though? Like, there are so many people invested in our country and our success.
I'm not a historian, but there are countries much older than America that are on much thinner ice. Look at Italy, right?
Well, we got the longest surviving document, our longest surviving constitution without reforming the government or anything. Fuck Italy.
Spain, Italy. I mean, they're old-ass countries.
Yeah, but we're fucking huge, man, and people love us. We got all sorts of people investing in our shit.
All I'm saying is pride comes before the fall.
You
know?
Sure.
I'm a careful person, and you want me to buy a plot of land that, you know, I want to, you're asking me to mortgage my life on a piece of land? Nah, fuck that. I'm just much more conservative, and, you know, I just don't want to be anybody's fool. And when someone tells you something's going to go up forever, they're asking you to be a fool. And, you know, I just don't think anything comes easy. And the idea that I could just buy an ETF and just go to sleep at night and not worry about it and watch my money grow like a fucking weed. Come on. You know, I wasn't born yesterday, and you shouldn't be either. And it's just one of these things that doesn't make sense. And if in practice, if you actually look at the numbers, again, you bought an ETF in 2000 or 1999 or 1988, you just got your money back a couple years ago, and that sucks. You know, being underwater and red for 10, 15 years, praying, hoping, despairing, and then finally in 2013, 14, 15, it comes back. That sucks, you know? I mean, that's not what you signed up for. So I don't know. Like, and this whole pension plans expect 7% returns. They're all realizing that that's probably not going to happen. And if there's 7% return, there should be 7% inflation, right?
Rationally, if everybody's money is growing at that rate, then why wouldn't businesses price accordingly? Yeah, I kind of understand what you're saying.
Reality is inflation is 2%. So
sure. I guess the difference is, I'm not speaking with authority or anything. I guess I have like maybe a naive belief in the long-term sustainability of the United States. It feels like you have a little bit less of that.
No, I think it's a great country, and we have an entrepreneurial spirit, and all these things are fantastic. But, you know, to assume that we're all going to get rich, just, you know.
Oh, yeah, no, that's stupid, yeah. I guess I'm thinking, when I think of my investments, my long-term investments, it's literally I'm putting money somewhere. If it grows, that's good, and then I have built up enough at retirement. Not I'm investing money, and these ETFs are going to make me fucking rich by the time I'm 35, you know, something like that, sure.
Yeah, hopefully not. But, you know, I think that if you diversified into buying the Japanese ETF and the European ETF, Latin American ETF, Chinese ETF, you've realized that, like, it's actually not easy to pick the right country.
Sure. I put all my extra money into fucking Twitter shares, dog, so.
YOLO. Latin America is going through a really rough time right now. You know, we're learning that whole fucking continent is corrupt and terrible. And we didn't know that 5 years ago. We thought it was just like China. We're wrong.
Just like China, not corrupt at all, or not as corrupt, I guess?
Different kind of? I don't know. Sure. But, like, it's bad. Like, Brazil impeached their fucking guy, like, twice. Like, it's really bad. And, you know, China is corrupt, but it's totalitarian. Like, they fucking acknowledge it, right? Brazil, we thought, was, like, you know, beacon of hope in Latin America. And it's a China without the fucking good parts. And so, like, you know, you try to pick what the next U.S. is going to be. And if you think it's the next U.S., God bless you, great. But you're still making a bet. There's an implicit bet when you buy a U.S. ETF that there's American exceptionalism. Mm-hmm. And if you want the last 20 years, you're basically saying, I'll bet my life that America's the shit for a 2% return. And instead, you can just sleep well at night, keep your money in cash, work on your career, and you'll probably make more money. I think people want a return no matter what. Like, I've had a lot of rich friends that they were in real estate, and they made great returns. They made like 10% plus returns. God bless them. But some of them are good at real estate investing. Some of them are not. And there's a skill to real estate investing. I don't understand it personally, but there is a skill to it. And there are people that can do it well and better than others, the same way I can do stocks, I think, especially healthcare stocks, better than others. I just, you know, the idea that, you know, a good 20% of the healthcare ETF, all ETFs is healthcare, the idea that, like, just that, you can't beat me in that domain, that alone is like, well, how do you, you know, there's a tech version of me, there's a energy version of me, there's et cetera. Like, you can't, this idea that you're just going to put money in the markets and make money is, I think, one of the broadest fallacies. The housing thing, same thing.
Look at Detroit. Albanians, people from my land, moved to America in the 70s. We settled on two cities. We picked Detroit and New York. One of them made a lot of sense, one of them didn't. We assumed that Detroit's economy would always be great. They pay you to buy a house in Detroit now. But in the U.S., in New York, you could have bought land in Brooklyn and turned yourself into one of the richest people, just buying different plots in Brooklyn, Lower East Side, out-of-favor apartment buildings in Manhattan. In the 90s, East 90s here, that was Harlem. Now it's one of the best real estate places ever. Detroit? Sorry, shit out of luck, picked the wrong spot.
Sure.
And, you know, it's sort of like, well, why do I have to gamble? Why do I have to? Is someone putting a gun in my head and saying, oh, go get a mortgage. Go borrow $5 million. Like,
sure. To be fair, though, I mean, like, when you're gambling on, like, a mutual fund or something, these are broad things covering lots of elements of the market, right? Whereas if you're in Detroit, you're there for manufacturing, and if manufacturing gets fucked, you're fucked, right? And for New York, if you go to Manhattan, if Manhattan real estate does good, then you're gold, and if it doesn't, you're fucked, right?
We take all these implicit risks that we're not really aware of, and I think that's sort of the rub. And we talked about this earlier, like the theme thematically, it's equivalent to sort of politics, right? Like, why invest into something that you can't control? Like, who cares who's the president? Who cares who wins the Stanley Cup? Who cares who wins the Super Bowl? Like, I can worry about me and make my life better. Or I can go worry about some shit I can't control. And the markets are like that. Politics is like that. And, like, this individualism is an American trait. It is, you know, we should be like, yeah, fuck everyone else. I'm about me. You know, Bernie Sanders is not going to pay my rent. You know.
Well, I don't know if you live in Section 8. I know what you mean.
All right. Well, look, I can't thank you enough for having me on your – you seem like you have a great community of people that love you and I mean, deservedly so. You know, you're open-minded, intellectual, and I'd love to be a subscriber if Twitch would let me have an account for more than 5 minutes. But thank you so much for everything.
Yeah, cool. I enjoyed the conversation a lot. It was fun talking.
Yeah, I should go eat something and get to bed. So yeah. Where are you based?
Omaha, Nebraska, dude.
All right, I saw that. Yeah, I mean, again, I'm a buffetologist and I love bright eyes, so.
Oh, fuck, I know of them both. We used to go trick-or-treating in that Buffett community where he lives. It's a gated community, but they'd open their things or whatever for trick-or-treating, and they'd always give out, like, the six-packs of the full-size candy bars. This shit was fucking crazy.
That's so funny. Well, nice to meet you, man.
Yeah, have fun. Good luck, dude. I'll see you later.
Have a good one.